Good morning to you from the North Carolina High School Athletic Association State Championships in Chapel Hill, North Carolina. Our broadcast presented by West Shore Home. A pleasure to welcome you back in to Keenan Stadium for this early morning kick alongside my broadcast partner and former Tar Heel, Melvin Williams, Jason Patterson here. A pleasure to have you with us. We hope your holiday season is off to a memorable start wherever you may be found. The championship weekend off to a memorable start. One of the storylines here, it's an early kick, but it is still a state championship environment, Melvin, so these young men are ready to go.
Oh, yes. The coach just said he gave them a biscuit and a juice, and they're ready to play some football.
As you turn your attention to this contest, you know it comes down to playmakers, and we start at the quarterback position on the East Duplin side of things, and that's where Zach Brown is expected to lead the
way. Well, Zach Brown is their leader on offense. He's been consistent all year. He's put up big numbers, and we expect him to do the same this morning.
As you flip over on the other side, we look at one of the key contributors defensively for Reidsville.
Paul Wetterman, 100-plus tackles this year. He's their vocal and their leader on the field. 132 tackles we see there, five sacks. So we got offense versus defense, and we're going to see who comes out on top this morning.
It's the 2A state title game, so you know Reidsville is here, right? Also a team from Duplin County. You can pretty much count on that this go-round. It's East. What do these two teams have to do to be successful? Let's look at our Ingalls food for thought.
Well, I think that Reidsville have to win the kicking game, and then they got to control the clock. And then on the other side of the ball, they got to, East Duplin got to limit the big plays and win the kicking game. I think that the team that comes down to having the ball last, I think the kicking game is going to be the outcome of this game this morning.
A little window into a shootout from Melvin there. It's time to check in for a little more on this matchup and how these teams arrived here with the third member of our broadcast team. Here is Rebecca Fiorentino. Rebecca?
Well, good morning, guys. It is an early morning, but for these two teams, they've had similar journeys on their way to this early Saturday morning. It's easy to forget that after week two, their season nearly went off the rails with a week two loss. They took that to heart. It humbled them and forced them to work harder. And that was an early wake-up call for their season. This morning, Reidsville had juice and biscuits, and they were off to Chapel Hill. And as for East Duplin, they had a send-off this morning at 6:45 a.m. with about 200 people there to wish them luck here in Chapel Hill.
Well, who is going to come out on top? That's the question that will be answered here in just a bit. I guess there's one toe left, all the fingers and all the toes. This would be the 20th for Reidsville. And you got an East Duplin team looking for a first state championship win all time. We'll find out what happens on the other side of the break. Kickoff coming in the 2A state title game from Chapel Hill right after this.
Let's all do our part to bench bad behavior at our athletic events. Officiating today's 2A state championship game from the Inner Piedmont Officials Association, referee Rick Curtis, umpire Robert Murray, head linesman Antonio Wallace, line judge Brent Carlton, side judge Keith LeFavors, field judge Jerry Glenn. That judge is Jared Torrance. The regional supervisor for the Inner Piedmont Officials Association is Jim Coleman. Thank you.
East Duplin and Reidsville colliding at Keenan Stadium in the 2A state title game. Our broadcast presented by West Shore Home. Happy to have you with us on this Saturday morning. The search for number 20 on the Reidsville side of things. And for East Duplin, this is a group trying to do something never having been done before. Talking, of course, about bringing home the crown. There you see the captains meeting. You've got Flippin and Johnson and Kelly and Price on the Reidsville side of things. For East Duplin, Hall and Gaby and Goss and Sanchez all out there meeting for the coin toss. We're about to find out who's going to have the football first. Differing offensive styles. We'll talk about that as they take the field, but similarities in their year. You heard Rebecca say a setback in the second game of the year at Page for Reidsville and at Princeton for East Duplin. Since that time, however, these teams have rolled off identical 13-game win streaks, and something's got to give in this one. And as you can see, we will see the crew out of East Duplin, the Panthers, with the football first this time around. Just about that time, Melvin.
Yes. And you know, it's early in the morning. We're going to see who had a good night's rest, a short ride here. And so I'm ready for some good football.
When you think about the journey here, of course, for East Duplin, they twice dealt with Wallace Rose Hill, right? That's kind of a rite of passage if you're going to work your way here. Did so with a victory in the regular season of 13-12 and then 28-26, the final for this crew in order to earn their trip to the state championship game, and rolling over the likes of Madison and Providence Grove and Chase and Maiden and Burns. That was the journey for a Reidsville team to make their way back here. And boy, these players, it's irrelevant the time of day right now, right? All they know is it's time to play for a state championship. And we are just about ready for the NC529 kickoff. It's never too early, even at 11 o'clock in the morning, right? Or ever too late to start saving for your child's education. That's the NC529 kickoff throughout the course of this 2A state title game. It's the mid-state 2A representative in the Reidsville Rams out of the West, and it's the East Central 2A representative, East Duplin, the Panthers, under Battle Holly. Christmas time means football championship, but there's got to be a Holly involved, right? You think about the storied history of his father and how the torch has been passed, one of the great coaching families in the state, and then the legendary Jimmy T on the other side and what he's done at Reidsville, making them title town in North Carolina. Those two pieces of history, along with everything else, coming together as we are set for the NC529 kickoff. And with the foot into the leather, we are underway in the 2A state title game. Return's going to be up across the 30 to the 33-yard line. That's about all that is available. And with that, we get rolling. Let us introduce you to the quarterback for this East Duplin crew. You saw him in the open when we walked through some of the challenges that are going to be there for this group and how he has provided the calming effect along the way this year. 5 rushing touchdowns, 18 passing touchdowns, 1,100-plus yards to his credit for the junior, Zach Brown, and a flag, much like we saw yesterday. Here's some of those early jitters. Got to stay home, and they're celebrating it on the East Duplin side because it's going to be a quick jump by the defense that will provide 5 yards before the first snap has to be taken. And again, Melvin, you really have to settle into these championship environments, these young kids.
Oh, yeah. In the first couple of series, we're going to see a lot of nerves out here, but they'll settle in, and we'll see a great football game this morning.
Zach Brown looking near side. You wonder how deep we're going to get into this one before we make the first reference, right? Zach Brown band out there on the field ready to go. Here he is leading them to the charge. The junior going to turn, give off, far side. You're going to see a lot across the course of this one of the combo of Avery Gaby, who handles the majority of the heavy lifting for this crew. You see him right there in the heart of the West Shore Home starting lineup for East Duplin.
Oh, yeah. So we're going to see Gaby. He's going to guy that's put up over 2,000 yards on the ground this year. He's going to get a lot of touches.
That's the West Shore Home starting lineup. West Shore Home bringing happiness to every home. And looking near side, you know, both these coaches, it's scripted, and they call it from the sideline. Got talented playmakers, but everything coming from these very experienced coaching groups. And nice play call here as we have our initial College Foundation of North Carolina first down. And that was just a matter of following the blockers for young Mr. Hall.
Hell yeah. And that just student body right, just line up and move your guy.
Isaiah Hall is a senior who rushed for 12 touchdowns this year. And here's the group trying to stop he, Gaby, Brown, and company. As you look at the Reedsville defense, who do you highlight?
So we're going to look at Wiseman and Mansfield. Those two guys had the two linebackers over 100-plus tackles between the two of them this season.
A couple of all-conference performers, a couple of juniors. 132 the tackle total for Weiderman, 127 the tackle total for Mansfield. We'll see how far those numbers rise today, as on the first down play, about a yard, and that is all, as they sit right on that North Carolina logo. Now, those are familiar colors for you that East Duplin is wearing, right? Fits this field as they stand on that
field.
Logo.
I'm looking at it. They look good down there.
Looks like an old Georgia Tech type North Carolina battle we got rolling here. We invoked that Ramblin' Wreck offense last night with some of the offensive style that we saw. The crew in the powder blue this time, more of the rushing group. In fact, East Duplin, as they stay on the ground right here, Melvin, with 70 rushing touchdowns along the way this season.
That is right there a lot, right there, that they believe that their guys up front can get the job done and they can move some people around. And so we're going to see them hand the ball off, but Zach can still throw the ball.
The other thing that you notice about this team, they've played in a lot of close games and they found a way to come out on top nearly all season long. So they are battle tested if this one should come down to the wire, which I know you expect it to.
I think it's going to come down to the end, to the kicking game winning this one.
Third down play as they look for another College Foundation of North Carolina first down here. And in behind the blockers right side, trying to spin forward, find just a little more room is Hall. And he is near the marker. But it appears as if they're going to spot him just shy. So fourth and short coming after this.
That's just a student body. They pulled both the guard and the tackler and kick out block. He might have should have kept following his blocker, but he decided to cut back inside.
His numbers on the year, 96 carries, 901 yards, and a receiving touchdown alongside three 100-yard performances, 100-plus yard games, three of them for Hall. We'll give you all the gaudy numbers for Gaby before the day is done as well. And this one goes his way, and he's got the first down and a whole lot more. Avery Gaby down the far sideline, and he's finally driven out of bounds at the two. Here's a first real glance at the playmaker on the offensive side of the ball for East Duplin out of the backfield.
Well, it's just a simple off tackle. He got to the corner, and you know, they do what they do. And Gaby is going to show us today that he wants the ball in his hand. He's a senior, and we're just going to see what they've done all year is run him.
Has the College Foundation of North Carolina first down, has him set up in the talk it out NC red zone for the first time. And here's the first down play. Another dose of Gaby striving for the end zone, and he's going to be stopped at the 1 yard line. I mentioned those 70 rushing touchdowns. Guess where 40 of them came from?
From
Gaby
number three.
With 40 touchdowns on the year. He's a little closer to the end zone here.
Just an off-tackle play right there. But, you know, you got to talk about the offensive line. And he don't get 2,000 yards on his own. It's them guys up front also.
Just underway, first touch of the football, first drive of the game. And it'll end in the latest of the Avery Gaby touchdowns. The senior all-conference performer from a year ago, back with a tremendous closing chapter to his career, has the opening chapter of the state championship game with the first touchdown going his direction.
Well, you know, as always, how do you want to start the game is kind of how you want to end the game. And East Duplin said they're going to come out and run the ball, do what they do best, and they showed us right here on this first drive.
13 100-yard rushing contest this season. He may be on the way to number 14 in the state championship game, and he has his team, the Panthers, on their way. A 7-0 lead for East Duplin as they make good use of their first touch of the football. We'll find out what kind of answer belongs to Reedsville on the other side of the break. The latest of the rushing touchdowns for Avery Gaby, and we are underway in the 2A title game.
When you work for a plan as good as Blue Cross and Blue Shield of North Carolina, you kind of feel bad for the other guy.
Will your plans let me see a specialist without a referral?
You bet.
Yes.
And you'll have plenty of options.
Could my family pay $0 per month?
Yes!
Plus, you could save with 3 free doctor visits and 0 copay for preventive care, virtual visits, and many prescriptions.
Find your yes plan today. Choose wisely, choose Blue.
Not too early for the East Duplin Panthers, their 2,000-plus yard rusher, Avery Gaby, rushing in the first touchdown of this contest. 7-0 lead in the 2A title game. Our broadcast presented by West Shore Home. Happy to have you with us for this early morning start. First of 3 today, the balance of the state championship weekend taking place over at Carter-Finley this afternoon and this evening. But we appreciate your commitment to high school football. I know this really gets your blood pumping when it gets to be this time of year, Melvin.
Oh, yes. Playoff football in high school doesn't come in, but especially in North Carolina. People talk about all the big states, but North Carolina has great high school football.
Everything rolling forward at 3 p.m. today at Carter-Finley. Tarboro, you know they're involved, right? A rematch with Mount Airy from one of those memorable championship games we talked about a few years ago, and then it closes up with Northern Nash and East Lincoln. That one happening at 7 p.m. tonight over in the land of the Wolfpack, just across the way at Carter-Finley Stadium. Here in Chapel Hill, good start at Keenan for the crew out of the east, and now a foot into it, and this is going to be a return chance for Reedville's Tamir Johnson. Johnson, one of the captains on this Reedsville squad, will take it across the 30 to the 33-yard line, and you now will get your first look at Al Lee, Mid-State 2A Player of the Year, set to lead this crew out. The junior is at 6'2", 210. He has 5 rushing touchdowns, but how about the passing numbers? 138 of 215 and 2,166 yards. His next touchdown through the air will be his 30th on the season.
But I'm looking at the completion rate, 64% of completion.
7 times picked along the way this year, if you're wondering. He's going to turn give off to Jeremiah Redd, and Redd moves forward for about 8 on the opening carry. Well, you've already seen Al Lee. You've already seen Jeremiah Redd. Let's take a look at the rest of the starting lineup offensively, our West Shore Home starting lineup for Reedsville.
Yeah, so we're going to be watching also their running backs and their receivers. They Flipping is going to be their go-to guy.
On turn, give back off in the direction of Redd. This time he's met. How about the front for East Duplin? There to provide the stop is Jackson Gauze, one of the seniors, one of the captains on the Panthers side of things, making his presence.
Well, that's where we're going to look at. Those guys on the second level right there making those plays.
Gauze is senior. This is senior-laden group. You know, interestingly enough, all the history may be there on the Reedsville side of things, but the experience, at least upperclassman-wise, is there on the East Duplin side of things.
East Duplin side.
First down. Lee dropping to throw, and he's going to take a deep shot, but that's got too much air underneath it. It is incomplete. Tried to connect with Flip, they call him, and you'll hear his name called early and often. Quayshawn Flippin, the junior, the intended target by Al Lee right here. Much more balanced for Reedsville. 40 passing touchdowns, 37 rushing touchdowns as a unit this year.
And that's where their success is. They don't depend on the run. They don't depend on the pass. And so they expect you to play a full defensive game here.
And speaking of the defensive game, here's the group trying to do that and slow that offensive attack, the West Shore Home starting lineup for East Duplin. Anybody else you highlight for East Duplin?
We're going to look at Kennedy.
Going to be quite a playmaker, no doubt. Screen set up far side. That's going to be another first down, a College Foundation of North Carolina first down as they move the chains. You're talking about Cade Kennedy, a team-high 139 tackles on the year. These are the type of things he'll have to contend with.
Oh, yeah. He's going to have to get out in space, and that's one of the things they're going to be doing. They're going to move the ball all over the field and see and make those guys in the middle run to the ball.
That's Deontay Neal. Doesn't show up on the depth chart among that starting group, but he's got a couple of rushing touchdowns, 9 receiving touchdowns. And with his defensive work, 14 touchdowns belonging to Deontay Neal. So 15 is going to be all over the field today. Keep an eye on him. He had the first down catch there, and then Reedsville quickly back to the ground. And Jeremiah Redd, who just does so much of the difficult work in the trenches. And You know, we talked about the experience. There's another senior in Rodrigo Sanchez, the East Duplin people saying, if you call Rodrigo Sanchez's name a lot, it's going to be a good day for us.
A good day.
And we get him in there pretty quickly here on a second down play coming for Reidsville on the ground again inside the 35 to the 34. Contrasting offensive styles again, much like we saw last night, Melvin.
Oh, yes. And they, you know, they're going to make them play all of their defensive scheme right there. They fake the out, ran quarterback draw. And so they're going to see what those guys in the middle are capable of doing. Are they going to run out or are they going to stay home and spy the quarterback?
What are we going to see from Al Lee, the junior? And his troops right here, going to bring a man in motion, faking the give, and then tried the slant right near the far side hash, but it is incomplete. And now facing a fourth down, this Rams crew on the opening drive. It's an interesting storyline that, yes, you have all of the experience for Reidsville, but this is a very, very young group. This is a rare occasion to talk about Reidsville and how will they handle the environment, but that's because of the youth on this team. We're going to find out a lot about them on this fourth down. And before we get it, a flag comes in. That is an interesting storyline.
Yeah, and you know, when you talk about the rich history that they have, and we talked about it earlier offline, is that they're a young team. How are they going to weather the storm of this big stadium, not in the comfort of their community home game? But I think that history and tradition is going to show its face today as well.
Well, this changes things. The penalty taking it back to the 39-yard line, and as a result, the offense departs the field in the kicking unit with Devin Shyrock coming out on to now take care of things. Shyrock will try and pin the Panthers deep. Good kick. Going to take a bounce at the four and well covered.
On the one.
So the Panthers, as that is blown dead with Mansfield right there to corral it on the 1 yard line, will take over in the shadow of their own goal line when you return to Chapel Hill. A 7-0 start to the 2A title game presented by West Shore Home.
Another game in the Charlotte area was postponed after student athlete tested positive.
Kids are accounting for a much higher percentage of positive cases than ever before. The CDC has officially given the green light to vaccinate younger kids.
Locations across the state are giving the COVID-19 vaccine to kids 6 months and older.
It's your shot to get back in the game. Get your COVID-19 vaccine today.
Had his team here in 17. Talked about the weather. Boy, that was one of the storylines of that day. Memorable. But you know that name. We said there's got to be holly around Christmas time in the state championship environment, right? One of the storied head coaching families in the history of this state. His team going to work from the 1 yard line after that tremendous punt by Shyrock. And he's opposite another coaching legend in Jimmy Teague on the other side. Boy, the coaching storylines here as good as you're ever going to find, Melvin.
No better than North Carolina when you see these two guys, these two families, I should say, standing on the sideline.
Yeah, and they've turned these communities into family affairs when it comes to the pursuit of championships. And you know, Coach Holly saying, we asked him, what ways are you like your dad? What ways are you different from your dad? He said he was an old school, no nonsense guy. I think in many ways I carry much of that forward. The basics of football are the basics of football, and he's got his team playing them well right now. Out to the 10, that'll create a little bit of breathing room as they end up putting it in the hands of Hall one more time. Every little bit helps right now when you're backed up against the goal line.
Right now, I just want to get some space so they can get in the comfort zone and start running their offense right now. So they're out to the 10-yard line. Now we may see them go a little deeper in their playbook.
A little bit of room to work with all of a sudden for Zach Brown and this crew. It was a rushing touchdown for Avery Gaby, his 41st of the year, that capped the opening drive, and now they go on what they hope is going to be one of the longest marches of the day. And so far, so good. That's a College Foundation of North Carolina first down as they will move the chains. And now with every play being run by the Panthers, a little more opens up in that playbook.
Oh, yeah. And you know, they started out rushing on the left-hand side of the offensive line. Now they're on the right-hand side. So they're going to make everybody play for Roosevelt. Little tall sweep right there.
Football on the ground, but it's going to roll out of bounds, so no harm done as it will stay with the Panthers of East Duplin. That was a moment where you catch your breath a little bit. Watch the football come out of here after it's in Hall's hands.
And so you got the quarterback blocking. You got two guards pulling. So you got everybody out front paving the way for the running back.
All-conference performer, the senior J.D. McCain, able to punch that out, but it's of little consequence as it's first down at the 25-yard line. Plenty to work with in that backfield. They go right up the gut, and the Reidsville defense was waiting this time around for Avery Gaby. He's quite a performer. Let's check in with Rebecca for a little more on the first touchdown scorer of this 2A title game. Rebecca?
Well, Avery Gaby is already a state champion in the 110-meter hurdles, and I asked him how hurdling can help you with football, and he said the ability to get his legs underneath him. He mentioned how a ton of NFL players used to run hurdles, including Todd Gurley, who ran in high school at Tarboro with Avery's current track coach, Kevin Strader. Avery said having Coach Strader as his track coach has taught him how to take his hurdling skills to a new level on the football plate. On the football field, and that has made a huge impact for him.
Well, we'll see how he uses those track skills across the course of the day if he gets in the open field. Thank you very much, Rebecca. Go back Hall's direction here, Melvin, and he's up near the marker. Another important third down coming after this run.
Well, you know, that's all Hall right there. They got him listed at 165 pounds, but he's a strong 165 pound taking tackles with him.
That was Deontay Neal on pursuit. Remember, Deontay Neal, we told you, will be a factor offensively. We've already called his name there. He has 14 total touchdowns, including his work on the defensive side with three interceptions returned for touchdown this year. But he and his comrades on the defensive side of the ball right now having trouble slowing this ground attack for East Duplin. Move the chains again. That's another College Foundation of North Carolina first down. Helping you plan, apply, and pay for college. That's the College Foundation of North Carolina sponsoring our first downs throughout this opening period.
All they're really doing, Jason, is just they're just lining up. One thing looking like Reeves was not comfortable in their defenses right now.
First down from the 38. A little toss, but pretty good penetration by that front for Reidsville this time. And among those in there on the stop, well, look at that entire front there. Haven't really called the name of Paul Weiderman that much yet, but he was your highlight player in the open. Keep an eye on number 5 and where he's located. He's right in the thick of things defensively for Reidsville constantly. There's a great look at him as you see the vitals on one of the key defensive performers in the state. Really directs that defense, does he not?
Yeah, he makes all the calls. He gets everybody lined up. But right now they're going with two tights and going in motion. And so what he has to figure out is which way, if they're going to run the ball and start sliding one way or the other. He's getting chip blocked. And so he's really taking himself out of play to me. He may have to take a step closer to the line of scrimmage, closer to the ball, and see what they do. So it'll be interesting to see if they make some adjustments on their alignment on the defensive side of the ball for Reidsville.
You're listening to the Tar Heel defender from back in the day, late in the mid-80s, he roamed these parts. Some great stories you've passed along. What are some of your big memories, though, from your days playing in high school, Melvin, before you came here and made such a name for yourself in Chapel Hill?
Well, the biggest thing for me in high school was, as we heard from last night from some of the kids and the coaches, it was about the community. Growing up in Rocky Mount, just that whole little town closing down and, you know, going and playing in front of the town every Friday night and getting that support. You know, that to me was, I'll never forget that.
That's a snapshot of America and what it's all about in the sport, right?
Oh, yeah.
Second down coming after the timeout called for by East Duke. ended up sending Cade Kennedy in motion there, and now East Duplin back at it for second down and nine. And gonna come near side. Here's another dose of Avery Gaby, and he's got another first down as he takes them into Reidsville territory at the 39-yard line. You're gonna see a lot of this all morning in this case and eventually afternoon long.
Oh, yeah, and right now, Duplin just telling Reidsville, y'all just gonna have to stop us. They're just lining up and outmanning them on one side of the ball or the other. You look right now, they're going to the power set, and they're just running the ball, quarterback, running the ball, Avery, right behind all those blockers.
Well, you talked a great deal about it last night, but it's worth revisiting maybe for fans who weren't with us that are just watching this 2A game. But discipline becomes so critical on the defensive side of the ball when you have to honor everything that East Duplin is throwing at you.
Oh, yeah, and that's just the way the game is today with the RPO. We saw with the triple option last night. And it's about playing discipline and assignment football. And that's what right now Reidsville going to have to figure out who their assignments are.
Rams up out of the stance and now back down ready to go on the second down play. Here's Gaby again. Host of white jerseys there, but they go straight to him and it's still good for about 3 yards.
So they went with the Wildcat right there, direct snap to Avery. They just lining up right now and saying, y'all going to have to stop us.
And showing a number of different looks that Reidsville is going to have to honor across the course of the day.
Oh, yeah. And you know, and that's what you have to do. You do what you do, but then you got to add that new wrinkle. And now what we're going to be watching, and I'm going to be watching, is Reidsville making the adjustments. And they're going to have to make some adjustments right now. Do you put eight in the box? Or do you try to play with your four-man front?
The other thing you know now with them running the football so effectively, possession's going to be limited. It will pass you by quickly. First quarter already gone. 7-0 Panthers after one in the 2A title game.
Every kid dreams about changing the world.
One day, I'm going to make video games.
Education makes dreams come true, and the NC529 plan allows you to start saving for their future now.
Someday, I'm going to make a difference.
It's tax-free, and you can start with as little as $25.
One day, I'll help people feel better.
NC529 helps you save for college and job training. Open up a world of possibilities for your dreamer.
Well, an Avery Gaby touchdown, the difference in this contest as we begin the second period of play. Welcome you back to the 2A title game, our broadcast presented by West Shore Home. And flags come in before we work our way into the first snap of the second quarter. False start will back them up just a little bit. We were talking about this offense for a little more on the unique style of this Panthers offense. Let's check in with Rebecca.
Well, the Rams haven't seen an offense quite like East Duplin's, but they did play Chase this year in the playoffs that had a similar style of running the ball. And J.D. McCain told me that playing in that game helped their confidence and gave them something to look back on this week. Their D-line played extremely well against a good O-line in Chase, and with a run team, it starts with winning in the trenches.
That's where the battles are taking place right now. You're absolutely right, Rebecca. Thanks for that report. Does help that you've had a little experience there, but the coaches also talk about, Melvin, how difficult it is to replicate. But all of a sudden, Panthers with the change of quarter doing something we haven't seen, moving backwards with a little trouble getting the snap off.
Yeah, look like they're a little anxious here with the snap count. But hopefully see if they're going to settle back in and get back to what they've been doing in the first quarter.
So it's going to be third down and a mile now. They need the 29-yard line in order to move the chains. A double handoff, and in the end, it's going to work its way to the 40. Maybe they'll call it the 39, so back where the original line of scrimmage would have been. But it is fourth down 10 from there, and you have to credit Reidsville. Well, it was as much about a couple of miscues offensively for East Duplin, but Reidsville looks like they're going to hold and get the football back here.
Yep, and that's what we talked about off air at the beginning of the game as to who can eliminate the mistakes. So right now, Duplin is falling behind in that category.
Fans from, as they term it, the football capital of North Carolina, looking to see their team get heavily involved here. Stepping right side and putting a foot into it is Zach Brown, who also serves as the punter in this case, and his team will watch this roll all the way down to the 13-yard line, and that is where Reidsville will take over. We mentioned the 19 championships. That's more than any other program in the state. And it's not historic championships. It's four out of the last six championships for this team that comes in with just one loss this season.
So when you talk high school football in North Carolina, you're going to start with Reidsville. They are the tradition for getting here. This, like I said, this is 19 times they've been in the championship game. So they have the history on their side.
Now looking for a ring, as we said, all the fingers, all the toes, try to get them all filled here with the way Reidsville has performed. This is the kind of impact you've seen from them across the course of the year as they turn to flipping once again. The junior's something special. 1,361 all-purpose yards for him. You're going to see this often today.
Oh, yeah. They just want to get the ball out in space and let him make something happen. And I think we're going to see in this drive right here that they're going to open up the playbook a little bit and try to move the ball down the field.
Quayshon Flippin, who has returned a couple of punts for touchdowns. He's got 16 total touchdowns on the year, and he's the catalyst for what's going to end up becoming a movement of the chains, a Hardy's first down as we work our way into the early stages of the second period here. And this is a good morning to remind you that breakfast is even better at Hardee's. They've got those super biscuits, and they're available until noon on the weekends. You still got about 22 minutes to get there, wherever you are. Now make sure you take the device with you. Don't miss a snap of the championship game. But you got 22 minutes to get there as breakfast is available until noon. Another toss in the direction of Flippin, far side. This is good for just a couple. I noticed you had the biscuits this morning as well. So
yes, sir.
The teams did it. You did it. We're ready to go. And if you haven't yet, check them out at Hardee's, sponsors of our first down plays. Here it is again, another glance.
Get the ball out of space and flipping it. And he wanted to make that first guy miss. Well, here's what we're seeing right here, Duplin running to the football. They have four guys to swarm the ball, and that's what it's going to take is to keep him surrounded.
Joshua Coates ends up wrapping him up, one of the seniors on the East Duplin side of things. Coates there on the stop. It comes near side. There's Neal again, and Neal is going to be run out of bounds at the 39. So he's going to make it a manageable third down here. Going to be an interesting play call for Reidsville.
Well, they are now, I think, settling down, Reidsville, speaking of, and really going into their playbook and doing what got them here.
That was another two-way player, Hall, who was on your screen there. You've seen him offensively already. And Isaiah Hall, one of the senior running backs, also handling defensive responsibilities. Flag's going to come out. They could not work their way back as they were in that neutral zone. And this is going to end up resulting in a Hardee's first down for Reidsville. So a handful of penalties here, a couple offensively that snuffed out and stalled that drive, and then now one that's going to move the chains on the other side.
Well, you know, we're still early in the game. Even though that first quarter went by, this is only their third time having the ball.
Go back out to that screen, able to make the first man miss across the 45 to the 47. That's about all on first down. You want to stick around at the half. We'll have the North Carolina Department of Health and Human Services halftime report. Special interview with the commissioner of the North Carolina High School Athletic Association. First half highlights, much, much more myspot.nc.gov, where you can find out all that's available to you from the North Carolina Department of Health and Human Services. Second down and 8 coming. And beginning to work Tamir Johnson in motion, just as a decoy for what was taking place in the middle. But undeterred was Jackson Gauss. He was not fooled for a moment getting in there.
Oh, no. He was right all on that. And that's what you want to do. You want to play on the other side of the line of scrimmage. And Jackson has done that pretty much all season.
Had a help from one of those other seniors, Rodrigo Sanchez, who went low that time and helped bring down the ball carrier. Those two forcing a third down. Looking for the 46-yard line. Looking for a whole lot more than that. Here's a deep shot for Reidsville. The coverage there, and it is incomplete. And that was Hall. You saw the reaction for Reidsville. Rams wanted a flag there, but none comes, and it is incomplete. Fourth down on the horizon. Take another look at this pass.
And so we're just playing safety help over top, good position, both defenders, and playing the ball.
They had both Neal and Tamir Johnson there, but I mentioned Hall, who was there to help shut things down. And number four there as well. Did you see a little bit of his action there? Also looked like it. Expect him to be doing a little bit of everything today also, as he's certainly one of the key leaders for this squad. Punted down to the 32-yard line, and that's where the Panthers will take over. Working our way through the second period, East Duplin out of the early advantage in the 2A title game. Our broadcast presented by West Shore Home.
Oh, this must be super embarrassing. Let me get that terrible driver I just got pulled over look. Wait, click. Perfect.
Whether you're a driver or a passenger, you're required by law to buckle up or face a fine up to $161. Click it or ticket, every seat, every time.
Well, it has turned out to be a beautiful morning trending toward afternoon on the campus of the University of North Carolina in Chapel Hill. Pleasure to have you with us. Melvin Williams is alongside. You'll be hearing throughout the day from Rebecca Fiorentino, who is doing a nice job for you, roaming the sidelines, gathering up stories, keeping an eye in close proximity on what's happening in this 2A state title game. Panthers back to work here across the 30 to the 35-yard line on this carry from Johnson, one of the seniors, 5 carries, 101 yards, no touchdowns in that department, 9 catches, 5 touchdowns of that variety for 221 yards along the way this season. He's been one of the key performers, and there's so many different weapons that the Panthers can bring at you, but they've used the ground game effectively. Coming into this drive, 20 carries for 132 yards, and of course the Avery Gaby touchdown, which is the difference right now. It's been an impressive look and different looks, as you've talked
different
about.
Different looks. They had different looks, and you know, they're doing double handoffs. I just noticed again, they hand it off to one back, and he hands it off again. So now we're going to see if they can continue to make those double handoffs. A lot of handling of the ball can cause problems.
Zach Brown, he's handled it well so far. Going to turn this time. It's a straight handoff. And how about the gap the offensive line created for Nziah Hall to run through? Hall's going to have a Hardy's first down here, but I again go back to credit that offensive line with the gaping hole they created in this moment.
And, you know, and they are what we call student body, right, where they're running, pulling the guard, pulling the tackle, kick out block, and he just finding the seam.
Waylon Sloan, the senior, Rodrigo Sanchez, also both-way player, the senior, the junior, James Stokes at the center position, Kevin Juarez, the senior, Jesse Parker, the junior, all doing such great work. That starting unit up front taking care of the heavy lifting. They make space again, and this is going to be good for about seven on the first down carry, at least six, depending upon where they spot his knee going down, right on that Tar Heel logo. Going to be second down and four. This is a team, we talked about them being battle-tested, Battle Holly's team. And that's because, you know, they had four games this year, Melvin, that came down to a two-point conversion. You might see that once or twice a year. Had it happen on four occasions, and we mentioned a couple of battles with Wallace Rose Hill, Cross County rival, who they were able to take care of business against 28-26 to get here after a 13-12 win earlier in the year. I mean, you look across the season for this East Duplin team, you're seeing a squad that has found a way to grind it out time and time again, and here they grind out another first down.
And that's what you want. You want to be able to win the close games, win the ugly games, and that shows the character of that coaching staff and getting the kids prepared to weather all storms.
The only loss was one of those two-point conversion games against top-seeded Princeton earlier in the year, just two games in. They've grilled 13 consecutive wins off since. One of the big reasons, Avery Gaby. Gaby already closing in on 100 yards rushing personally yet again. He has the touchdown, and he's got him near first down yardage one more time. In fact, it's going to be. Move the chains. That's the latest of the Hardys first downs for the Panthers. Well, he's already making a case, right, to be the player of the game when all is said and done. We'll have our West Shore home player of the game at the conclusion of this contest. And an early candidate, no surprise, Avery Gaby, with the way he's playing already.
Well, he didn't get 2,000 yards walking.
He's adding to that total here today thus far. This is going to be Gaby again. He's met near the 30-yard line and driven out of bounds. 5:14 to go and ticking downward in the second period. What are your takeaways from what we've seen thus far in the first half?
Well, I'm looking at the guys up front for Reeswood. Duplin is doing a lot of pulling, a lot of reach blocking. But what I'm seeing on Reeves' side, they're not getting off the blocks. I think that's the difference right there, why these backs are getting the yardage that they're getting, is because Reedsville not getting off the blocks.
They're going to take a timeout and talk about it as we speak. Reedsville taking one of their first half timeouts. We'll take it as well. Back with more from Chapel Hill on the other side of the break. Well, a good crowd having turned out for the 2A title game. A lot of pageantry on display and highlights already there. You'll want to stick around at halftime when you get a chance to look at the highlights, the stats. It'll be the North Carolina Department of Health and Human Services halftime report, special interviews with North Carolina High School Athletic Association personnel, a whole lot more. Don't miss the halftime report coming up here in just a bit. Hall given the football again. He's down to the 25-yard line. Going to make it a little more manageable on the upcoming down, which is going to be third and about two. East Duplin on the march again. If you weren't with us from the very start, they took the opening drive, turned it into a touchdown scoring drive for Avery Gaby. Neither team having done much since. The defenses have been the story since that time. But here are the Panthers on the march once more, and that looks to be enough. It is. On second effort, no question, it's going to be a Hardys first down. The drive continues for East Duplin.
Well, they're doing what they've done all season, Jason. They had 513 carries. They averaged 8 yards per carry. That's big right there. And that's those guys up front. When you're talking about, you know, Avery now is over 100 yards right here before halftime. He's doing what he's done all season.
They have now played 16 games this year, counting this one. 14 times he's gone over 100 yards, including today. And he's well over 100 yards as he goes to work left side. Flag comes in at the end of this as he gets across the 15-yard line, but we'll have to see what the flag is. As you see, Stuplin working back just a little bit. That's in the holding area, and that looks to be what it's going to be.
Now it looked like the wide receiver got tangled up with the guy he was blocking. They all was on the ground, so he must have taken him down.
Going to stall this drive momentarily as they'll take it all the way back to the 28-yard line. Line to make is the 10.
10-yard penalty. Repeat first down.
As you see the official word come in from our referee, you'll get a good look at it right here.
Yeah, he not a lot, but he did grab the back of his jersey.
Kept Lorenzo Mendoza, another of those tremendous linebackers, from being able to get anywhere near the football. Near side, out of bounds at the 23-yard line. On the carry is Hall. Hall, by the way, is up over 60 yards on that carry. He's touched the football 9 times, with Gaby having carried it 17 times for now 112. That's how they've split the responsibilities for the backs.
Yeah, but they average 8 yards a carry all season between the two of them.
You want to say that again?
8 yards a carry.
Wow. Just speaks volumes to how they arrived in the state championship environment. Looking to that sideline for the call is Zach Brown. He has 5 rushing touchdowns of his own. We showed you the 18 touchdowns passing, up over 1,100 yards. It's have been a steady dose of the running game more than anything else thus far when you think about it. This is a crew that, you know, visions of what we saw last night. The passing game has not been a part of this at all yet. 30 rushes, 186 yards, and that's the total of what's been their offensive performance.
Well, I'm sitting here and I'm watching this, and your receivers don't get the opportunity. They're not getting targets, but they're blocking. They're part of what is being asked of them by their coaching staff, and they're just executing right now.
Down under 3 minutes remaining in the opening half. They started the half with a touchdown scoring drive, trying to cap the half with that. And battling inside the 10 is 10. Finally going to be drug down at the 3. And with the football stripped away, Reidsville coming this direction with it as McCain will take it to the 18. And every indication we're receiving is that it's going to be Rams football up near the 20-yard line on a tremendous play by J.D. McCain. And you see the coaching staff for East beside themselves at the result. But when Reidsville needed a play defensively, Coach Teague's team able to get it. And you can thank J.D. McCain for it.
Oh, yeah. And, you know, his forward progress has not stopped. He's still driving his leg, offensive line, him. And great play by number 2, just rip the ball out and go the other way.
J.D. McCain, one of the seniors, one of the leaders on this group. Another of those all-conference performers, and not liking the outcome on the near side. The East Duplin crowd, who thought they were headed toward a 2-score advantage. Instead, here's Reidsville looking for a 2-minute offensive drill that would result in a tie game at the half. My, how things changed on that one defensive play.
One play right here. He's still driving. JD just rips the ball out.
What will the ultimate swing be on this play by J.D. McCain when you consider that we were staring down the barrel at perhaps 14-0 at the half in favor of East Duplin? And again, if Reidsville goes on one of their patented drives here, you could be looking at a game on equal footing when we reach the halftime report here in a moment. Rolling out far side is Lee. He's got a man beyond the marker. Boy, nice route and a strong delivery as this is caught for a first down. Hardy's first down secured on this toss in the direction of the freshman, Kendre Harrison, there to make the catch. What do they do on the Hardy's first down play? 2:01 remaining here. You can see a couple of timeouts still available, as one was taken by each team earlier in the half. So keep that in mind as they take the final 153 for a spin. This disrupted. There's Brecken Bowles, who is going to get his name called at a key moment here late first half. It's going to be second and 10.
Well, he just stared down his receiver right there and made it easy for the defender that time.
Looking for the 40-yard line to move the chains with the Hardys' first down here. Second coming for a Reidsville team that has 36 passing yards and 67 total yards in the contest right now. Flags come in ahead of the second down play. Back Reidsville up a bit on the false start. Untimely, this penalty.
Oh, yeah. It's a little odd today for both of these teams with the number of penalties. They pretty much disciplined, penalty, mistake-free teams.
Yeah, a couple of crisp and, as you said, disciplined teams. But we saw one drive for East Duplin stall a little bit after back-to-back offensive motion penalties. And here Reidsville's got a little further to go, as they turn in the direction of flipping one more time. He's up across the 30. That'll bring it to third down and about, looks like eight going to be needed with 1:39 to play in the half. Timeout for a injury at the 32. See if we can get a number on who that is down on the far side for the Panthers. And the training staff out to tend to the injured player. So far, so good across the course of the weekend in that everybody we saw a little banged up last night working their way back, and that the good news, and you certainly hope that will remain the case across the course of the weekend as we have our first real stoppage for any type injury here late in the half. Training staff very intentional on that far side there. Melvin, the one thing you want to see, you know, the one request you have coming into the weekend, everybody remains healthy and now beginning to sit up on that far side, which is the first good sign we were looking for. You can see now that for East Duplin, it's Tayshawn Johnson, a wide receiver cornerback combination that he provides on both sides of the ball.
Yeah, you know, it's those things, unfortunately, we do see injuries, but that's, you know, part of the game, but we want, you know, we always want these kids to come in and lead the way they came in healthy.
One of the things he reminds us of when you see him on both sides of the ball as well, just how much Iron Man football we're seeing in this 2A title game.
Yeah, and that we talked about a little bit. That's not common when you, especially in your bigger classes, the 4A, 3A, definitely in the 4A, that a lot of guys going both ways. You might have some guys that do some specialty stuff. But down in the 1A and 2A, we see that a lot just because they don't have the bodies. And it comes back to conditioning. You know, can that guy go at a high level and be safe and play on both sides of the ball?
Johnson up under his own power, which is a beautiful sign. And the other piece of that, we've seen the quarterbacks up both days, right, who've been back there in the secondary when needed in
when
big
needed,
moments.
Yeah.
That speaks to keeping your athletes on the field when the game is on the line. So good news is Johnson works off near side, and we go back to action with a third down, and they're going to call it eight. The 40-yard line, what is needed by Reidsville, trying to make something out of this final drive, one would think, of the first half, and able to go over top of the defense and work it into East Duplin territory as they connect one more time with Kendre Harrison. I'm going to share with you again, this youngster is in his freshman campaign, Melvin. He's at 6'8", 230, and he's a force to be reckoned with as he catches this pass.
Well, he got, look like soft hands, runs a good route, big body, big target, and just a freshman.
Remarkable. Your eyes deceive you when you look at Kendre Harrison.
Well, I saw him in warm-up, and I was like, ooh, that's a big boy.
And he's only going to get bigger. Plenty of room to grow for this young man who has a tremendous future. One of the latest, greatest of the performers for Reidsville. There's Flippin, and he's got a first down, a Hardy's first down inside the 26-yard line, and he's working closer toward what would be a talk-it-out NC red zone opportunity for a Reidsville team. Well, you talk about changing the narrative toward the end of the half. They have 80 seconds with which to take all the good work that was done by East Duplin across the first quarter and a half plus and turn it into equal footing here. And, you know, he's been around the block a time or two. Coach Teague and his staff knowing how to seize the moment.
Yeah.
Showing blitz, and they were able to push Gauze through into the backfield quickly, but kind of worked against them a little bit here as the play goes opposite direction down to the 17-yard line. And it is, in fact, a Talk It Out NC red zone chance. Start the conversation. Stop underage drinking. Talk It Out NC, sponsors of the red zone chances in this one. And here comes a final minute red zone opportunity for Reidsville.
Yeah, I'm a little surprised that East Duplin hadn't called a timeout to settle their guys down on the defensive side of the ball.
Hey, speaking of Iron Men football too, Melvin, that was Weiderman who carried the football that time, who's one of the key defenders we've talked about. He's got 7 rushing touchdowns, a couple receiving touchdowns on 5 catches this year, does the junior Paul Weiderman. You see him there playing offensively as effectively as he does on the defensive side of the ball.
Well, you know, like I said earlier, we see that a lot at the smaller classes, but you still got to have that guy that has the heart and the athleticism to be able to play on both sides of the ball. And today, thus far, those kids that have gone both ways have done the job.
A Hardy's first down at the 16-yard line. 44 seconds. You have to be very intentional now in the playbook if your Reidsville. We were talking about Harrison a moment ago and his tremendous size and athletic ability. Let's check in quickly with Rebecca for a little more on Harrison.
Yeah, guys, no doubt he stands out on the sidelines because he's the only one of that height standing at 6'8". Tamir Johnson told me that he thinks Kendrick forgets sometimes that he's that tall and acts like he's 5'6". They have to remind him that it's okay to act your height on the football field. He's just a freshman, so sometimes he needs those little reminders in order to continue to grow as a player. And Coach Teague told us that the sky is the limit for him.
Yeah, still a lot of youth in that body. You have to kind of grow into it, right? Here's the first down play from the 16 and fighting for open real estate on that left hash, but it's stacked up pretty quickly by East Duplin. Panthers with a mindset on coming up with a stand here that would keep the 7-0 lead in effect, and the clock stops with 37 seconds remaining as timeout is called for by Reidsville here. Circle this moment in the ball game, right?
Yeah, and you know, we just talked about the big body. We down here. I'm surprised that they had him out one-on-one over there. That they didn't run some kind of corner route, fade route to him at 6'8". All you got to do is lob it up there to him.
Yeah, use that size to your advantage. We'll see what comes out of the playbook here. What all's open to if you're Reidsville based upon what we've already seen on this drive, Melvin?
Well, they got, you know, pretty much the playbook is wide open. The middle of the field always is open in high school. High just does not defend the middle of the field. So it's pretty much whatever they want to do. It's just calling that right play right now.
Jimmy Teague now, second all-time North Carolina High School Athletic Association history and wins at the same school, 333 of them in nearly 3 decades, 27 years at Reidsville. He calls the play to the corner. They heard you, Melvin. They were thinking right down the line with you. And it is incomplete as they do roll the dice in an effort to go Kendre Harrison's direction. Try to use the size.
The quarterback got to realize he is 6'8". So let him play at 6'8". He could have got that up a little higher. He brought the corner into play with throwing a low ball.
Look at how much he towered over Zach Brown there. And Brown is, he's no midget, right? He's no small guy, but everybody compared to Harrison right now is, you know, we're not playing peewee football, but he certainly makes it look that way. Staying on his feet to the 3-yard line as this is going to be tossed that direction, driven out of bounds. What do they call it? Mike football, peewee football.
Pee-wee.
He'll make it look that way.
Oh, yeah.
We're not going to go down there and stand beside of him. I'm certainly not. You could. Here's a toss out far side, and you see the eventual drive out of bounds coming from Hall when it counts.
Yeah, so, you know, Red's going to make plays. And so right now we're just going to see, got 26 seconds to go before halftime, first and goal. You know, they're probably going to run this first one and see what happens.
Getting out of bounds, allowing them to settle in here. They keep it on the ground, stacked up at the 1-yard line just outside it. With 20 seconds and ticking downward left to play now. Hustling back to the line, Reidsville trying desperately to get into the end zone. Clock at 8. Snap coming at 7, and they will spike the football with 6 seconds remaining. And Reidsville has that to work with in front of a third down and goal.
Brings up third down and goal for the Rams.
So this is your play right now with 6 seconds remaining. And getting set and doing what you just saw is off the table here. As you throw it on third and do it quickly, it comes down to this one play. Let's see what they opt to go with. And now timeout is going to be called for, as it looks like East Duplin is going to take the timeout to talk it over ahead of the third down play. Well, this may be the play. It's certainly shaping up that way that determines whether we have a team with a lead or perhaps a tie ball game at the half.
Oh, yeah. This right here is going to have to draw up a good offensive play, but I still think you got to use your receivers right here. If you get an incompletion, you got some more time on running the ball. You might run out the clock if you don't score.
If you do a quick hit, though, through the air, you're probably going to have a second or two left with which to
Absolutely.
Work. So that gives you do you want two plays? Do you want to call that one play on the ground that would be the final play of the half? If you can get it in there, fine. If you can't. So those are the options that are on the table with 6 seconds. We'll see what the Rams decide to do right here. Fans getting into it. You can hear them on both sides.
Yeah.
Lead on the line for the Panthers of East Duplin as their defense is backed against the goal line. Lee sends Neal in motion, tosses it his direction, and they do go to the skies for the touchdown. You know, when he caught that and worked into the end zone, there were about 2 seconds left. So they had a chance, had it been incomplete, to run another. That obviously the thought process, as well as the effectiveness of Deontay Neal. Remember, we told you Deontay Neal had 14 touchdowns with a couple of defensive touchdowns, the 9 receiving touchdowns. He just secured his 10th here in the state championship game. He's been one of the go-to playmakers in key moments, and pending the extra point, he will have evened up the state championship game with as it rolled on off after he caught it and rolled on into the end zone, no time remaining in the half. Wow. Nice play call. Nice execution for Reidsville. The extra point is true, and it is 7 apiece at the break.
And that's what, you know, that's good coaching, good time management of the clock, and good play calling. And you got to, you know, lead the kids out. They have to execute what the coach is calling.
And I go all the way back, Melvin, to J.D. McCain's play on the other end of the field when it looked like East Duplin was going in for a 2-score lead. He had the strip ball, the takeaway, that ignited this drive and allowed Reidsville to tie the football game.
And, you know, that's one of the things I look at sometimes, the kids trying to get that extra yard. But as a defensive coach and defense, we teach when they holding one guy holding you up to strip the ball, sometimes you just have to go down. Just go down to the ground, go back to the huddle and run the next play. And that just cost them.
Sometimes you tip your cap too to a guy like McCain just making a tremendous play, and he did change this game. We get to hear from both coaches. Rebecca's standing by. Rebecca.
Well, Coach, I know there's probably some frustrations there with how that last drive ended, but your defense looked optimistic early. How do they continue that?
They played good there. You know, we played hard the whole half. We've dominated the whole half. We just got to come back out and do the same thing second half and hold on to the football.
Your team has had a lot of close games already this season. What's going to be important to remember as you go into this final half?
I mean, we've been here. Okay, we're battle-tested. We just got to finish.
All right, Coach, thanks for your time. That's Battle Holly, the head coach for East Duplin. Stay with us. We've got more to come in this halftime. Second half coming your way. East Duplin versus Reidsville.
Are you applying to college?
Do I need to? Technology's the future.
How about you?
For what? Influencers get paid.
For what? To help take the skills you have now and make them even better. Education at one of North Carolina's colleges or universities can help you take those skills to the next level. Get all the tools you need to plan, apply, and pay for college at cfnc.org.
In 100 counties in North Carolina, we have over 800 agents. We are within the communities, and our job is to help you. It's not just a business relationship, it's a friendship. North Carolina Farm Bureau Insurance. Helping you is what we do best.
Welcome to the North Carolina Department of Health and Human Services Halftime Report. MySpot.nc.gov, your spot for COVID-19 protection.
Hey, 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 what's up, everybody? I'm Nelson Weston. Thank y'all so much for tuning into the high school state championship football games right here on Friday Night Rivals. Who better to join us than our good friend all the way from Ingles Markets? Y'all know her, the famous Melissa Levin. Melissa, how's it going, my friend?
So good to see you.
Always a pleasure to see you.
Happy football, happy championship weekend.
Happy football, happy championship weekend indeed. Melissa, it does raise the question, though. You guys have had a longstanding and proud sponsorship and support of the community for a long, long time now.
Right.
Why is this important to y'all?
Well, Ingles is a corporation, but all of our stores are in the hearts of our communities.
Indeed.
So we are the beacon of those communities. So we support everyone in our stores, our customers, our schools, our first responders, our businesses. We are part of a community, not part of a big corporation. So this is just a very natural way for us to go. And believe it or not, a lot of the people that play in these games work in our stores.
Oh, yeah. That's super indeed.
Right?
Now,
from
what I gather, y'all have a terrific Tools for Schools program. For those who are unfamiliar, what exactly is that program? But more importantly, how can the good folks at home get involved and support it?
It's very simple to get involved with it. You have an Ingles Advantage card.
Mm-hmm.
You go online and register that card to the school of your choice. Every time you shop at Ingles, not only are you earning fuel points, but you're also earning points for your school that goes directly into the teacher's hands. And this works into the classrooms. It's not just athletics, it's mathematics and science and social studies. It provides supplies for the teachers, it supplies food and security elements, supplies continuing education opportunities. It is a true educational program.
That is outstanding. Melissa, all this talk about football and state championships, I don't know about you, but I'm getting so hungry right about now.
Really?
If I want to make a pit stop to, say, Ingles, for example, on my way to one of the games, what are some of the most popular, delicious, and, of course, mouthwatering items on the menu I can pick up?
I'm going to tell you, let's go to the wing bar.
Mm.
Okay, that's the absolute okay. That's where we're going to start right there. Then we're going to stop and get a Boar's Head sub, and then on our way out in the car, we're going to grab a big bucket of fried chicken. Now, we are good?
That is magnificent work.
Thank you.
On behalf of WLOS, and, of course, on behalf of the entire community, thank you so much for y'all's proud and resounding sponsorship.
We love our partnership with you, too.
We cannot do this without y'all. Again, Tom Brady might be the GOAT of football, but I tell you something right now, Ingles is undeniably the GOAT when it comes to proud community sponsorships. I'm ready for some more football.
I'm ready too.
We know y'all are ready for some more football, so without further ado, let's get ready for football!
Come on, Paige, we're almost done.
Christmas, the season of giving. At Ingles, we know that nothing brings a family together quite like the holidays. And nothing brings a smile to our faces quite like sharing that perfect gift. This Christmas, let's give what's in our hearts thoughtfully and cheerfully. Merry Christmas from Ingles. All the ingredients for family.
Welcome to the North Carolina Department of Health and Human Services Halftime Report. MySpot.nc.gov, your spot for COVID-19 protection.
Here with North Carolina High School Athletic Association Commissioner Q Tucker. Commissioner Tucker, we appreciate your time. We're looking forward to great games this weekend.
Absolutely, and thank you guys so much for this opportunity to be able to just talk about our championships.
How exciting is it for you to get to this point of the football season?
You know, the last couple of years, once COVID hit, everything was, you know, up in the air. We didn't know whether or not we would be able to have a complete season in some instances. And so just to get to this point is pretty exciting.
Well, and there's many familiar teams in this year's state championship games. What do you think makes these teams so successful year in and year out?
One, it's the dedication of your head coach. It really starts at the top. That coach's philosophy, how they choose to conduct their offseason, how they choose to approach the season once it begins. And I think another factor has to do with the community buy-in to those programs.
What's been the biggest challenge for the association in the last year?
Well, obviously, the officiating challenge has been very, very real. When our football regional supervisors met early on in the season and talked about the numbers, some were very, very concerned that they would not have the numbers to be able to put a crew on the field. And I want to give our officials a lot of credit. I'm not aware of any games that were never played or had to be changed because they, one, didn't have any officials, or two, officials did not show up. And so that's a credit to those officials who did commit to working in our program. And our regional supervisors also are to be commended for their creativity in trying to work with athletic directors and head coaches to get those games scheduled.
What are you most proud of as an association accomplishing this year?
I am just delighted with the principals and athletic directors for their work in those leadership roles. And then I'm just delighted with the work that our coaches have done. They've overcome a lot in this fall season. I just think hats off to the people who work in our schools. They're doing a lot to help young people be prepared to be the citizens that we want them to be once they pass through those halls and get that high school diploma, that they are positioned to do great things.
We appreciate your time, Commissioner Tucker, and thank you for your leadership this season.
Thank you so very much, and we appreciate what you guys do to spread the word and the message of education-based athletics.
The new COVID-19 boosters are safe and even more effective. We know that the COVID-19 virus continues to change over time as it continues to spread in our country and around the world. The new boosters give us all better protection against the COVID strains of the virus that we now see in our communities. You have a spot. Take your shot.
Stay protected against COVID-19. Find the updated booster at myspot.nc.gov.
Welcome to the North Carolina Department of Health and Human Services Halftime Report. MySpot.nc.gov, your spot for COVID-19 protection.
And now it's time for the MySpot Medical Timeout, your spot for COVID-19 protection. With us today is Dr. Charlene Wong, Assistant Secretary for Children and Families at NCDHHS.
The new COVID-19 boosters are safe and even more effective against the types of COVID-19 that we now see in our communities. The boosters, just like the original vaccines, have gone through rigorous clinical trials to make sure that they're, number one, safe, and number two, importantly, effective. These COVID-19 updated boosters take into account some of these newer strains that we've been seeing in the country and give us stronger protection. If you test positive for COVID-19, it's really important that you stay away from others to not spread the virus. You can go onto our website at myspot.nc.gov/findtreatment to also find sites where you can get tested and treated all in one spot, and you can do that even if you have no health insurance.
Stadium. We have a 7-7 contest. East Duplin scored on the opening drive of the game, and Reidsville scored on the closing drive of the second quarter with 2 seconds to play, no less, as time rolled on off the game clock following the touchdown. puts us at 7 apiece. It's time to look at some of the numbers and some of the highlights. And Melvin, there is much to talk about when you reflect upon what was a highly competitive first half. And what may be most surprising is you look at the no passing yards on the east side of things. Haven't had to do that just yet. And no turnovers for Reidsville. The one turnover was huge.
So you know, looking at the no passing on East Duplin's side, we saw that last night. State championship won with no passing and yardage. But you still can't count out the balanced attack that Reeves will have. And that one play, the one turnover, defender made a great defensive play, changed the outcome of the first half.
Were it not for J.D. McCain's strip of the football, may have been 14-0 at the half. Instead, it ends up being a contest of 7-7 as a result of his defensive play in the ensuing drive that follows. We had a chance to hear from Battle Holly just a little bit ago. He talked about how his team battles. He's appropriately named. They're appropriately named with the way they have performed. And he mentioned how dominant they had been. No doubt he reminded his team of that when he went into the locker room. It's going to be interesting to hear also what the legendary head coach of Reidsville has to say, what Jimmy Teague's take is on this contest as he works his way toward Rebecca. It's going to be interesting to hear from both of these coaches and watch the adjustments they make from that perspective as we move forward. So closing in on the second half, giving you an extended period of time to take a look at our numbers from the first half of action. You can see total yards at 142 Reidsville and, of course, East Duplin at 208. And now we check in with Rebecca.
Coach, what was your reaction to how your team was able to close out that first half?
Yeah, scoring right there was big to tie it up. We've had a tough time slowing that wing tee down. They're doing a great job of executing it, and it's going to be a dogfight. We knew it was going to be.
You told us this week that it takes two things to be a great championship team, discipline and hard work and being able to come together. What did you tell your team right there in that huddle before they took the field?
Well, we've got 24 more minutes. It's going to be a dogfight. We know that. Again, we got to find a way to get some more points on the board and find a way to stop them again.
All right, Coach, thanks for your time. Best of luck.
Thank you.
Guys.
3 decades of dogfights, really. 27 years that he's been at the helm there. What a tremendous run it's been. And you get the thoughts of inside the mind of one of the legendary coaches in North Carolina. Let's take a look back at the highlights from the first half. What stands out to you from the first half of action?
Well, I think that East Duplin settled in and what they wanted to do and what they do best is run the ball. The offense got good push. Reeves going to have to make some adjustments on how they're going to play up front.
That was Avery Gaby doing the heavy lifting, scoring the first touchdown of the game, the only touchdown of the game for East Duplin, although Hall did carry much of the load. Here was the strip. That was J.D. McCain's play, which changed the complexion of the first half. And then in the end, they toss it in the direction of Deontay Neal as they score the touchdown with 2 seconds to play, which ends up putting a 7-7 score in effect at the break. We'll come back second half right around the corner in the 2A title game, our broadcast presented by West Shore Home.
Hey, conductor, how about something new? You played this last year.
Come on, get your head out of your sacks.
Shh, we're trying to hear.
Well, I'm sick and tired of hearing your kid play the wrong notes.
Where's my kid solo?
At least you can see your kid. Why is my kid stuck way in the back?
The conductor only plays his favorite.
Boo! My kid heard that solo!
You say it like this?
Yeah!
Getting set to begin the second half of action at the 2A state title game. North Carolina High School Athletic Association Ultimate Weekend, Championship Weekend for 2022 continues. Our broadcast presented by West Shore Home. Nothing settled between these two combatants, East Duplin and Reidsville. Just about ready for the third quarter, and we get set for our NC529 kickoff. Never too early, never too late to start saving for your child's education. That's the reminder as we have the second half kickoff. And Reidsville will look to build upon the way they closed the first half as Deontay Neal, who fittingly enough caught that touchdown pass to bring the half to a close and tie the football game, has the return here, and he's up to the 27-yard line. Have to feel pretty good right now if you're Reidsville, Melvin, when you saw East Duplin, for the most part, dominant numbers-wise in that first half. They put themselves in a position to take a two-score lead, but then you equalize at the end.
Yeah, they put themselves in a position and to really come out now and start fresh. It's back 0-0 and now build on what they ended the first half with.
Can they turn this into number 20, being a charm this time around? Rams with the 19 state titles, more than any program in the state. Number of different players they can bring at you. And here's Paul Weiderman, the junior who plays both ways, works his way up across the 35-yard line. That's a pretty good first down gain. Adjustments for Reidsville, if you see any that are necessary.
I think on the offensive side of the ball, I think they got to start utilizing their skill players a little bit more. Not totally rely on the run. And then on the defense side, they might have to get out of character and load the box and do something with their being outmanned up front offensively, defensively.
Give you some of the individual numbers here in a moment, which is something we haven't talked a great deal about. Neal's got some pretty good ones. He has a catch here, and that is a College Foundation of North Carolina first down. In the receiving department, Neal with his fourth catch there. He's right around 30 yards. Does have the touchdown reception at the end of the half. Flippin has caught four passes. Harrison caught a couple of passes. They used his size. Red has caught a pass out of the backfield. That has been the group receiving those passes from Al Lee thus far, who is 11 of 17 for 103 yards. And the one touchdown. He'll tuck it this time. Lee showing you what he can do with the wheels. And he's going to be across the 50 and into East Duplin territory at the 44-yard line. So a couple of different ways he can make it hard on you. And Al Lee will move the chains.
Yep. And so we see right now that they have opened up. It was a pass play. So they've run the ball twice. And then they've thrown the ball twice right out the gate. And so now they're going to see what East Duplin is made up on the defensive side of the ball and see if they can stop them in one facet of that game, run or pass.
Interestingly enough, just his second carry of the football game, and it comes here in the early stages of the third quarter. Keep that in mind. Seven carries for Jeremiah Redd, 21 yards. Three carries for Weiderman, 21 yards as well. They've done most of the lifting in that department. To the sky, who else? Using the size one more time of Harrison. And he rumbles all the way down to the 12-yard line. If you missed it when we talked about it in the first half, for all that size, he's in his freshman campaign. He's one of the key weapons. Take a look at this play.
Just the run, roll out, throw to your big target, and let him catch the ball and do what he does best, catch and run.
Using every bit of that size to place them into the talk it out NC red zone. You saw that pop up top left corner. Talk it out, start the conversation, stop underage drinking. A talk it out red zone chance for Reidsville. Well, you talk about the way they bookended the end of the first half and the start of the second half here. If this ends in a scoring drive, this is going to be the first lead of the game for a Reidsville team that would have taken the closing stages of period number two, the opening stages of period number three for a spin. There's Neal with the football again. For more on him, let's check in with Rebecca.
I asked Tamir Johnson how he's seen freshman Deontay Neal grow up this season, and he didn't mention anything about his football skills, but rather his mentality and emotions. Tamir said, "We got him to come out of his shell. He finally started to show some emotion, and that translated to the football field. He's able to express himself more."
Well, he certainly did so at the end of the half, didn't he, Melvin?
Oh, yeah.
Had the catch that put this team on solid footing with East Duplin, and they are looking for more right here. Second down from the 10-yard line. There is a first down available at the one. They're thinking touchdown instead, but there's too much air underneath this, even for the size of the freshman Harrison. It's incomplete.
Well, I like that play. Even if it was incomplete, I like it that they're utilizing their resources now. I think they didn't do enough of that in the first half to use on the offensive side of the ball, their resources.
East Duplin had Tayshawn Johnson, the senior on the coverage that time as he got the rough assignment of bodying it up against Harrison, right? But it's incomplete. As we said, the pass too tall. Here comes third down. Into the end zone, and that also incomplete. They tried to look back Neal's direction one more time. Harrison was there. They actually ended up running together when all was said and done. Here comes the fourth down play. Well, you can read the tea leaves from what you see at the half often as you get one more glance at this incompletion. And what we saw at the half was Ivar DeYoung come out and practice field goals in the 30-yard range or whatnot, knowing that this is the type of game trending toward coming down to a field goal. He's going to attempt a 27-yard try right here, but it is blocked right back into the hands of Reidsville, and then it's going to be taken perhaps the distance here as it ends up in the end in the hands of East Duplin. And Elam Moore showing you his speed. The junior takes off with it. How about the turn of events on the field goal try from Reidsville as East Duplin has an early third quarter moment? Boy, that changed quick. And
well, I have to give Elam Moore credit that he knows the rules of the game.
Yes.
Everybody stopped except for him. Yep. Officials are talking about it, but you didn't blow your whistle, so that's a live ball.
Yep, he kept going. You said it with the continuation. And East Duplin looking to celebrate what not only was somewhat of a defensive stand, forcing the field goal try for a Reidsville team that looked to be rolling, but they believe they have a touchdown on the other end of the field, and we will find out from our officials here as they gather up and talk about what's as important a decision as we've seen in this football game right now.
This is huge right here. This is huge.
Our referee Rick Curtis will fill us in momentarily. He's joined by Robert Murray, Antonio Wallace, Brent Carlton, Keith Lefevers, Jaron Glenn, and Jared Torrance. That the grouping that has been given,
the extra point team.
Been given the responsibility and honor of calling this state championship game. They're still discussing it, but you know, East Duplin doing everything they can to sell it. The Panthers, as you said, are sending the team out there to kick it. And here comes the verdict from our head referee.
During the run back, sideline interference, East Duplin. The penalty can be taken on the try or the kickoff.
So the
result of the play is a touchdown.
Flag drop had nothing to do with the outcome of the play. It was a sideline interference penalty, which, as you likely heard, is going to be enforced either on the kick or on the PAT try. So the touchdown in effect. And how about the two plays we have seen, the one toward the end of the half from J.D. McCain and then the one from Elam Moore that you just witnessed on the East Duplin side of the things, and the way they turned the tide on both occasions, it looked like it was going to be points for one team. It ended up being points for the other, and as this is punched through by Bonilla, take one more look. That came right back to Reidsville. That's what I thought had it in their hands initially. And then it's taken away, and then it's taken home. And when the dust settles on Elam Moore's long touchdown run, East Duplin is back out front. The twists and turns of the late second quarter and early third quarter in the 2A championship game with our broadcast presented by West Shore Home memorable to say the least. Let's go back and recap them for a moment. You had East Duplin going in for what looked like was going to be a 14-0 halftime lead. That's before J.D. McCain decided to strip the football away. Reidsville went on the march, made it 7-7 at the half. You had Reidsville march down on the opening drive of the third quarter, looking as if it's going to end in points. And on the field goal try, even though it bounced right back into Reidsville's grasp, Elam Moore never quit on the play, took it the distance. And that's a swing the other direction that makes it now 14-7 East Duplin. Just when you think you've seen it all, who knows what remains. And here is Neal, and he's got a pretty good seam up to the 46-yard line, and that's where it'll take over. And the moral of this story, when all is said and done, Melvin, is you never quit on the play.
Never quit on the play. The whistle never blew, and he kept playing.
And that's the case for both of those young men on the strip, as it looked like East Duplin was going in, and on the field goal. And it's just a reminder that you keep on digging and you keep on playing. So Reidsville is going to try to respond pretty quickly here as they have the ball up near midfield at the 46-yard line. We're going to give you another look at that on the backside of this play because it's worth revisiting the job that Elam Moore did. He believed when no one else did, there was something left on that play. Rolling near side is Lee. He's going to be met. How about the defensive performance to stand tall by Brecken Bowles? The senior rises above and drives him to the turf. Here's the kick one more time, and it's obviously the play of the game nominee. Play in everybody else's mind is over until it is taken away by Elam Moore, and he never looked back.
I mean, he know the rules of the game.
Second down. Well, both teams shaking their head on a moment, right? One on a strip where you said, go down with the football, and the other on a field goal attempt that they thought ended in a block that ended up being much more than that for East Duplin. This tossed out far side. Reidsville trying again to respond, and here's Jeremiah Redd, who's
got an illegal block up top.
Yep, going to be working his way backward after the flag is down at the 38-yard line. But so important, and for both of these teams in both cases, to shake it off quickly, Melvin.
And that's what you have to do. You cannot let one play define the outcome of your game.
Just when you think you've got points, and they go up on the board the other way. Here's the call.
10 yards from spotting the foul. Repeat second down.
So back Reidsville up a little more. They're going to need a country mile now, right, to get the first down. They need the 44-yard line on the Panthers' side of the field in order to move the chains with the College Foundation of North Carolina first down. Long way to go here on second and forever. That's where you would expect that passing game at some point to come into effect. They move Neal just a little bit. And this is picked. Once again, it is Bowles. He came in there and had the big stop defensively on Al Lee a moment ago. And here he comes away with the INT. Have a third quarter for yourself, Brecken Bowles.
Oh, yes. And, you know, being in the right place at the right time. But somebody at the defensive line, let's see if we can see it in the replay, who tipped that ball.
Bowles ends up on the receiving end of this, but you said it, the good work done up front to create the chance. Brecken Bowles, he's been a tremendous performer all season long, Rebecca.
And he actually broke his collarbone freshman year and didn't play his sophomore and junior years. He plays basketball with a ton of these guys and has a relationship with them. And Coach Holly convinced him to come back for his senior year. He understands it's a commitment, but he missed it and he wanted to come back out for one last year. Once he made the decision this year, he was all in, 100% committed, and Coach Holly has been really impressed with how he's been playing.
And he provides the spark in this moment. Take another look. You said it, right up on that front. Big paw on it, and it ends up in the grasp when all is said and done of Bowles. And there's one more glance at Kleinsmith, who was doing his best, it looked like, to try to get in there. After a defensive penalty, it's first and five, and they're celebrating it on the East Duplin side of things as they are trying to get Reidsville a little rattled here, both off of the field goal continuation play and now the interception, which have come bang, bang here.
And there's the big kid right there, Harrison, number 18, making the stop. Everybody plays two-way here.
Yeah, it's Iron Man football, regardless of what colors you're wearing on this Saturday morning, now turned afternoon. as we close in on the 1 o'clock hour in the third quarter of the 2A title game. Happy to have you with us. Melvin Williams, you're here and here. Rebecca doing great work for you on the sideline. I'm Jason Patterson, and it's our pleasure to have you with us for the second consecutive contest, the first two of four this weekend. Everything continuing at around the 3 o'clock and the 7 o'clock hour over at Carter-Finley to wrap up what has already been a tremendous weekend of championships, and we appreciate your commitment to high school football to be a part of it. Third down coming for East Duplin. One thing we know, you may be driving in to score, but nothing certain in this game right now.
Nothing right now.
Brown ran into some trouble as he tried to follow those lead blockers, and you credit the push that was secured by Reedsville right there, and nobody may be more so a part of it than Tyrese Turner, one of the sophomores on the line who got in there. Just a little shake of the head from Zach Brown. In the end, he got just enough to move the chains. It is a College Foundation of North Carolina first down at second effort making the difference.
Yes. So right now, East Duplin is taking their time, getting the call from the sideline, and just methodically going about their business right now and running their offense.
Big third down conversion. They're 4 for 7 in that department today. Flag comes in right in the midst of the traffic amongst all the big bodies at the 10-yard line.
It's typically holding in there.
It is going to be just that against East Duplin. 4 of 7, as I mentioned it, on third down. Contrast that with Reedsville, 3 of 6. And East Duplin also converting on their lone fourth down try today. So third and fourth down, a combined 5 of 8. That's pretty good efficiency. Here comes the official call.
10-yard penalty, spot of the foul. Repeat first down.
Brings it back to the 19-yard line. It'll be first down all over again. And now goal to go from just inside the 20. Another talk it out NC red zone chance for the Panthers. Here's that double handoff again. This time waiting on it was that front. And Harrison, well, he ended up wrestling him to the ground as he fell down in the end. But I thought he was going to get away for a moment there, Melvin. Young man, as we said, growing into the tremendous size he's been blessed with. And he's an outstanding athlete. Watch him wrap up the ball carrier initially. But if we've learned anything in this game, right, keep on playing.
Keep on playing, because he almost got away.
That's certainly what Cade Kennedy was trying to do right there. Second down and goal from the 21 after a loss of a couple on that play. These coaches have to be, and many of these fans feeling like, calm this thing down into a rhythm a little bit. It's been wild of late between these two, but highly entertaining. Brown looking to throw. And he'll roll far side. Harrison was on pursuit. He was not alone. Aiden Mansfield was there to provide the contact. You know, you came into the game talking about Weiderman and Mansfield, and this is one of the premier moments for Mansfield thus far.
And that's where, you know, their linebackers are the leader of this defense right here, and with both of them over 100 tackles between the two of them. And this is really the first time we've called Mansfield's name since early in the game.
Reedsville's defense rising to the occasion at the 5.5-minute mark third quarter, and it's third down, goal to go from the 21-yard line for East Duplin. Zach Brown pulled out there as if he's going to throw the ball that time. Hasn't happened in this football game, a completion through the air for East Duplin. Everything has taken place on the ground. 37 plays for 212 yards in full, and timeout is going to be taken by the Panthers ahead of this third down and goal from pretty good distance here. What's going on in your mind and what's going on in the huddle for the Panthers right now?
Well, they want to protect the ball. They want to make sure they get the right call, even if they don't pick up the first down here. But they don't want to cause a turnover. We've seen two turnover plays that kind of change the outcome of where we are today.
5:30 to go, as we said, third quarter, as these two teams look for an advantage in the 2A title game. Our broadcast presented by West Shore Home. We appreciate their partnership across the course of this weekend, bringing happiness to every single home. How about the energy down there on the field? It well represented these two programs, Rebecca.
Well represented indeed. This East Duplin side, you've got fans in the stands on their feet. We've got cowbells in their hands. We've got cheerleaders all over here. They can feel this energy and sense the way that they've been playing. They've been rallying around their fans.
And on the head of this third down, they're going to need every bit of that energy. Big third down and goal. Going to toss it to Gaby. He's got the corner, but will only be able to make it to the 10-yard line. So fourth and goal coming from the 10, and decision time now in effect for the Panthers.
Well, they look like they're going to take the 3 points.
How about Gaby on that run?
Well, that's what they do. I mean, they average 8.6 yards per carry, and they felt like they can get the bulk of that back on what they do best is running the football.
So the junior, Darwin Bonilla, out for what would be a 26-yard try from the 16-yard line. He puts a right foot into it, is able to get this beyond the line, which is an accomplishment so far in this period, and he puts it through the uprights to extend the lead. So 10, the advantage. That's the high water mark on either side as East Duplin will cap this drive with a Darwin Bonilla field goal. A little bit of breathing room, perhaps, but a whole lot of football left. We'll be back with more of it on the other side of the break. You're watching the 2A state title game from Chapel Hill, the broadcast presented by West Shore Home.
The new COVID-19 boosters are safe and even more effective. We know that the COVID-19 virus continues to change over time as it continues to spread in our country and around the world. The new boosters give us all better protection against the COVID strains of the virus that we now see in our communities. You have a spot, take your shot.
Stay protected against COVID-19. Find the updated booster at myspot.nc.gov.
Well, in 2017, they competed for the 2AA title, a tight 16-14 contest, and a loss to High Brighton. This is the second trip to the state championship environment for East Duplin. So far, so good. They've grown the lead to its high water mark with that field goal from Bonilla at 17-7, and the fans who've made the trip from out east enjoying themselves so far as we have the 5-2-9 kickoff, the NC 529 kickoff. We'll see what kind of response there is for Reidsville. Not much of a return there for Trey Poteet, who brings it back. And here comes the Reidsville offense out onto the field. You've been impressed with what you've seen from the Panthers so far.
Yes. And, you know, and back to that last possession, Reidsville only allowing East Duplin to come up with a field goal and not a touchdown. We still got 5 minutes to go in this quarter and another quarter to go, so it's still a lot of football left that may keep them in the game, not scoring that time.
Tremendously important with a team that had so much energy. A flag comes down before this begins to develop as Reidsville runs it out near side with Jeremiah Redd, and we'll sort the flag out back at the 26-yard line. Yeah, things were really energy and momentum-wise. We were talking about it with Rebecca, trending the Panthers' direction. So to kind of stay that and hold it to the 3 points, you're right, Melvin, very important.
Very, very important. You know, and really we got the two odd plays and the unusual for these two teams, the penalties have been the outcome of where we are.
Think about it. Penalized 6 times for 49 yards on the East Duplin side of things, and you just heard the call against Reidsville there, now also penalized 6 times for up over 30 yards in the contest. So you said it, two teams known for the disciplined nature of their play, and yet the state championship environment making it a challenge from time to time. Nice screen set up far side up near the 40-yard line to about the 38. That's where Tamir Johnson will take the football. Three touchdowns, 406 yards, including a long of 80. Had an 80-yard touchdown earlier in the year. They set him up on the screen far side. Positive yardage.
Positive yards. And when I have to give credit where credit is due. They are using their weapons this second half.
It's a Reidsville team, of course. We talked about this being the second trip for their opponent, East Duplin. 26th trip for this crew. They know a little bit about it. Here's Weiderman. He knows a little bit about this. Flag comes in at the end of this, and Weiderman a little slow to get up atop that North Carolina logo. He has a College Foundation of North Carolina first down into East Duplin territory, but they toss the flag in there at the very end of this play, which may mean a little more tacked onto it. We'll see.
A face mask, I believe.
That's what it looked like.
Personal foul, face mask, defense, 15-yard penalty, from the end of the run, first down.
The Hawkeyes and my broadcast partner spotting that right away. Here's a look at the play in full.
Well, here's our guy that we featured on the defensive side of the ball, now getting some touches on the offensive side of the ball, being effective in the game.
Again, he had 7 rushing touchdowns across the course of the season, a couple of receiving touchdowns, only 5 catches, matched his jersey number with the total catches, but 2 of those for touchdowns, 9 total TDs for Weiderman, who does get so much attention on the defensive side of the ball. From the 32, Neal. And in and out of his hands, almost picked off on the carom, but incomplete. It falls harmlessly to the turf. Boy, that was close.
Very close.
Close to a catch for Neal, and then close to an interception on the backside. And look who that is, a bit slow to get up in that secondary. That's Zach Brown, who is another of those spending time on both sides of the ball. He's the QB for East Duplin, and he's going to take a moment for the training staff to tend to him.
And it looked like he got cramps. And that's where you got guys going both ways. You know, at the end of the season, these young bodies taking a toll right now. Can they finish strong? We've seen a lot of guys, and we talked about it last night with the temperature, not being in the middle of the summer, cramping up. But we're talking about 17 to 18-year-old bodies that's in week 16 of a physical a sport, and we see that today, cool weather, but we see a lot of guys today going both ways.
It's a right you earn to play this deep into the season, but it is a challenge you face as well.
Yes.
When the wear and tear is there, you're able to reach down and find a little more because it's a championship environment, but you see the toll it takes on these young men, and a nice hand for Zach Brown as he works his way toward the sideline as he battled through some of those cramps. Rebecca was talking about the pageantry a bit earlier. You see it on display here. A lot of energy in the building for an 11 o'clock start, as you would expect.
Oh, yeah. Well, you got history, and you got, with Reidsville being here, not comfortable, and they know small community, and we saw it last night, small community, the support with their teams, they travel. And that is the beauty of high school football, to have communities that travel with these kids.
And just how much history? It dates all the way back to 1930 for Reidsville, these championships, from the 30s all the way to a couple of years ago in that 20-21 campaign. 30, 31, 32, 37, 39, 40, 43, 45, 50, 54, 02, 03, 07, 08, 09, 16, 18, 19. We don't want to take up the whole quarter, but then 20 and 21. Those were the 19 championships. They're looking for the one for that final toe, which covers all fingers and all toes
posed
with 20 of them. For a little more on the tradition that is that program, here's Rebecca. Well, we'll try to check in with her again in just a moment. Reidsville to work here on third down. As they go to Weiderman, stop. So a fourth down is coming. Fourth down and 3. So the drive contingent upon this play call, Melvin.
This right here, they got to get it right. If they don't get this first down right here and turn the ball back over to East Duplin, they may be throwing a little dirt in the hole on themselves right here.
Here comes the fourth down play. Awaiting the snap, looking at the options. They got the The big man down on the lower side here. Problems and just getting rid of it with nobody in the area. In the end is Lee, and you love the pressure that was provided and the difficulty on the snap at the wrong time for Reidsville.
Yeah, I don't know if the quarterback in the center was on the same snap count, because he looked like he was looking away and the ball was on top of him. Let's look at it in replay and see. Oh, it's just a bad snap.
Yep, went right off his right hand, and by the time Lee gathered it up, blue shirts everywhere and nowhere to go with the football. That's a second key stand. You know, you had two drives in this half that looked like they were going to be scoring drives for the Rams, Melvin. One ends in the block kick that kept on going, the block kick that wouldn't end, right?
The other way.
And the other ends with a turnover on downs. You got to credit this East Duplin defense.
Well, they're bowing their necks, and they're with that bend but don't break mentality right now. And that's what you need to win championships.
Another thing that they've used to try to win a championship today, consistent work from the guy who scored the first touchdown of the night, Avery Gaby. And he's been something to watch in this one. Didn't take much time for him to get up over 100 yards in the game. He's got his latest 100-yard contest of the year, his 14th for those who weren't with us earlier. And he just continues to carry the load for this group. They're going to ride him heavily along the way, Rebecca.
His nickname is the Commander, and I asked how he got that nickname, and Dante Hall told me if you knew him in person, you'd understand. But I was told that Avery comes from a long line of a military background. His great-grandfather, grandfather, and father all served, and his brother is currently serving in the Marine Corps. He adopted the nickname by tight end Chase Pierce, but the nickname came from when they were all playing basketball together. So watch out for the Commander running through.
Well, he has been the Commander today, has the touchdown run, as we said earlier in the contest, and he's now at 122 yards. His next carry will simply be his 22nd, and you were talking about where those average numbers are per carry on the year for this team. Yeah. It's remarkable.
Yeah, and so they're going to the Wildcat. You know, Zach went out of the game, so they're going right now to the Wildcat look, snapping it right to Avery.
Relying heavily upon him on cue, just as Rebecca was walking you through some of his history. He is, as Melvin said, engineering this offense now, and he's done so to the tune of the latest of the College Foundation of North Carolina first downs. Yep. Got a player down for Reidsville now, it would seem. Is that Harrison who's down? And he's, it would appear, dealing with some cramps as well at around the 36-yard line. And he got a good look into the heart and the brain trust of that group on the Panthers' side. And, you know, you wonder just how long before Brown can return. There is Harrison, who's being tended to by the training staff. Comes as a bit of a surprise for you, doesn't it, Melvin, that we see so many of these players kind of cramping up on this cool morning start, now turned afternoon?
Yeah, you know, it is dehydration, but also, you know, how much stretching. You know, that's probably one of the things that these young kids are not doing a lot of. And then you also, you're talking about, you go in at halftime, you come back, they do a couple of leg lifts, look, crossover, karaoke, and then they back playing. Is that the best way to approach it? Probably not. And so now we're seeing all this cramping going on.
Yeah, both Dawes and Harrison being seen to. Harrison starting to limp off now. And, you know, the other thing is you get here an hour out, you hit the field. Some of the coaches were talking about condensing their pregame a little bit because of the new environment in the state championship.
Yeah.
I wonder if that plays in any way, shape, or form. But you know these players and Harrison limping off now are going to return as quickly as possible with what's on the line here. We hope to see him back very, very soon. First down from the 36-yard line. East Duplin up 10 and looking for more as they've turned away to what looked to be effective Reidsville drives in succession now. And 1:18 remaining in the third quarter as they go to work. Up to the 41-yard line, just continuing to snap it to Gaby. He continues to work his way through traffic. You'll take five or six on first down every time you snap
every
it.
Every time. But, you know, they also, now you got to look at that, they're playing without the quarterback, too. So they're going to show the Wildcat look. And so here is where, you know, Reeves will have to do something different to put them in a passing situation to even see if they will pass without a quarterback.
Still have the Commander, though, and he's the guy handling the football right now, and he goes right into the pile up near midfield and near that Tar Heels logo. They're going to spot him at about the 43-yard line. So just a couple more needed in order to move the chains here. You know, for all the work Brown has done through the air, we talked about 1,161 yards passing and the 18 touchdowns opposite the 5 rushing touchdowns he's had. Just the 1 attempted pass today for this group through 3 quarters. They are ready to take us into the 4th with a lead of 10. It's been the Panthers of East Duplin so far. A lot of football left and a lot of football history for Coach Teague and his crew. We will be set for the final quarter of football. This broadcast as well brought to you by West Shore Home. We heard from the folks at West Shore Home yesterday. Let's go back and revisit that interview that tells you a little more about their proud partnership with North Carolina.
We're joined now by Frankie King with West Shore Home. Frankie, thanks so much for taking the time to chat with us here today. Why is it important for West Shore Home to partner with Friday Night Rivals?
Obviously, well, yeah, we're part of the community, so it's very, very important. It's extremely important. When you think about, I mean, all of the, you know, the hardworking people that really make this thing happen, right? Our football players, our cheerleaders, everyone else that's involved in it. I mean, it engulfs community, right? The fact of the matter is, I mean, as a nation, when you think about the nation itself, it embodies exactly what it is that we're supposed to do, which is bringing everyone together, and that's exactly what we appreciate here.
You mentioned the community. What does it mean for West Shore Home to be so involved with the community?
Oh, I mean, it's amazing. I mean, just being able to partner with, you know, Sinclair Broadcasting and some of the others, right, just to be able to bring puzzle pieces together as one entire community, that's important. Plus, you got to understand, Rebecca, this is football season right now, right? So these guys have really worked hard. They practiced hard really to get to where they are right now, right? They've taken extreme ownership just to be able to get better every day and be exceptional teammates, right, which is really a part of our core values here at West Shore. So this is our community, and we want to make sure that we do everything that we can to build a partner to make sure that it's successful.
Well, Frankie, we appreciate your partnership. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
Are you applying to college?
Do I need to? Technology is the future.
How about you?
For what? Influencers get paid.
For what? To help take the skills you have now and make them even better. Education at one of North Carolina's colleges or universities can help you take those skills to the next level. Get all the tools you need to plan, apply, and pay for college at cfnc.org.
The first period belonged to the Panthers of East Duplin. Reidsville answered in the second quarter, the third. All Panthers again, 10-0 in that quarter. Who will own the fourth and final quarter of the 2A state championship game? It begins with a carry near side, and you can move the chains on a third down conversion. How about third down today for East Duplin? They've now converted on 5 out of 9 tries on third down. Also a fourth down conversion, and this Hardy's first down keeps this drive going opposite a Reidsville team needing a stop right now, Melvin.
Oh, yeah, they need a stop right now. This game can get away from them. They're still in it, But they need to bow the next right here and get off the field, the defense does.
Down 10 to start the fourth quarter, having come back from a 7-point deficit once in this game to even the score at halftime. And it continues to be Avery Gaby receiving the snaps. We saw Zach Brown depart a little bit earlier. Looked like he was cramping up on the defensive side of things. And so without the quarterback, it's been Avery Gaby handling that along with everything else he's done today. He's had a 137-yard game rushing on 25 carries. He had the opening touchdown of the contest. So Avery Gaby has been as advertised today.
Oh, yes, sir. And, you know, and keep talking about those guys up front. There's no Avery without those guys up front making way for him.
You got that right. That offensive line has been something special all season long for East Duplin. And Gaby going to bring it near side, near the 50 at the 48. So third down and 9 coming. And let's give them a little more love. Waylon Sloan, the senior. Rodrigo Sanchez, who plays both sides of the ball, also in his senior campaign. The other seniors, Kevin Juarez on the line. Then James Stokes, the junior, at the center position, and Jesse Parker, that group doing such good work all season long.
And so we're right here at third and 9, which is a big down right here for Reeves. They got to get off the field right here. They got to get off the field. And they want to give themselves a chance.
Imploring their fans to get in behind them here, yeah. A team familiar with the championship environment, calling on the fans to give this defense a lift. Here is the third and 9 opportunity to get off the field and running in behind those blockers one more time and spinning forward to the 45, but just a few yards shy. So a fourth down coming. And it's going to be fourth down and a long 3. We'll see if they call it 3 or 4 when all said and done here. Inside 10 minutes separating one of these two teams from a state championship trophy. And coming back out there, how about this, to punt it away after giving way to Avery Gaby is Zach Brown, who's set to try to pooch this down inside. As he's out there to try and pin Reedsville deep, but you always got to think about other things too when it's on the opposite side of the field and a quarterback's there. This is blocked right back to him, and now lunging forward after snagging it toward the marker. And the ball looked like maybe at the very end of that. Did it pop out one more time? Nope. Looks like
he ran. Well, he blocked it right back to him, and he ran.
It blocked right back his direction, and then in the end, it's up near the marker, and they're going to have to stop the clock to measure this because it was a fortuitous carom right back to Zach Brown, Melvin, that he took forward near the first down marker when all was said and done. Here's the block in there to get a hand on it was Tamir Johnson. But this is up near the marker once he lunges forward. And they're going to measure to see if it was enough to, in the end, move the chains. Talk about the ball not bouncing your way after coming away with the block. That's kind of been part of the day for Reedsville, hasn't it?
It's been Reedsville day. And that right there, I don't think I've seen that happen too often where the ball is blocked back into the punter's lap.
It looks like they're going to stretch this out, and he's going to be about a yard shy. But doing a little bit of everything today is Zach Brown, and he tried to run for the first down there. So Reedsville set to take over. Before they do, let's check in with Rebecca for a little more on Zach Brown.
Well, we asked head coach Battle Holly what makes this group so special, and he said they're a bunch of selfless guys. They don't care who gets the credit, including Zach Brown. And I had a chance to talk with assistant coach Brian Aldres, who's been with the program for a while, was a head coach here, and he's watched these guys grow up, but he says that they are a bunch of selfless guys who really, truly do not care who gets the credit.
And Zach Brown and the band staying back out there on the defensive side of the ball. Zach Brown in the secondary. He'll come up, try to make a stop. Here's Reedsville. They go to Harrison. All right, Melvin, turning our attention to what Reedsville was able to do there. They get the defensive stop. You're down a couple of scores, but there's 9 minutes left in the game. Give us Reedsville's mindset right now.
Right now, they're looking at, they got to put points on the board. The defense did what they were asked to do to get the ball back. So now the offense got to put some points on the board. They got to put some pressure on East Duplin. East Duplin is in that comfort zone right now, and Reedsville got to step up and put a little pressure on there.
Reedsville, 155 yards passing, 240 yards total, 85 of them rushing in the contest so far. This will pad that total just a little bit as inside the 40-yard line and down to the 39 this time around goes Jeremiah Red. They've used Red. They've used Widerman effectively, 37 yards for Widerman, 27 yards plus the game you just witnessed for Red. Neal has carried the ball three times for 23, but he's caught three passes as well for four passes, I should say, for 23 yards and a touchdown. So look for Neal wearing jersey number 15. And on cue, what do? But send it right his direction immediately on the snap. And this one is handled, though, as coming in to make the stop is a guy you talked a lot about in the open. Cade Kennedy steps up and is there.
And so the Reedswood don't have to panic right here. They're behind, but they got 7 minutes to go, so they don't really have to panic yet. They just got to get a good series this time right here.
Now closing in on 150 tackles this season. He was the team's leader coming in, Cade Kennedy, who you saw right there. You said it, Reedsville with plenty of options still on the table. Pressure this time, but still plenty of time to throw it for Lee. He's got a man, and it is caught, and it's going to go into the end zone for the touchdown. He had the defensive performance that turned the game in the first half, and here he has the reception that keeps Reedsville in the thick of it. J.D. McCain again, and Reedsville is right there.
Right there. And they did everything. They didn't panic. They stayed within the system, got the ball to the playmaker that they wanted to get the ball to, and they come out with a touchdown.
And if you weren't with us toward the end of the first half, what we're referencing, he stripped the football away when it looked like at that time East Duplin was going into score in position to go up 14. And just when it looks like they're in position perhaps to stop Reedsville, put the football game away here late, he has the answer for the Rams. And this extra point to pull within three as it is straight up and through off the foot of DeYoung. And we have ourselves a tight contest in the fourth quarter. How about this off-balance toss, by the way, from Al Lee as he connects with the receiver?
Well, you know, Al Lee, he's not going to hurt.
Takes us to break. Back with the balance on the other side. Could we have asked for more? This group of Rams, this group of Panthers entertaining us down to the wire in the 2A state title game. And we get ready for the NC529 kickoff with just the field goal. A separation now between these two teams as they battle it out for the 2A title. Our broadcast brought to you by West Shore Home. And here is the NC529 kickoff. Never too early, never too late to start saving for your child's education. You know, we at this point, Melvin, we're just kind of spectators enjoying this thing. Now, this is going to go out of bounds, and it will be a penalty for the kick out of bounds. It'll mean pretty good field position in response here for East Duplin. But these are the kind you come to the ballpark for. These are the kind you enter the stadium hoping to see, and these two teams have not disappointed. We'll get the call here and then talk about that on the other side. Here is the official word. So after the kick out of bounds, it goes to the 35. But, man, this is everything you could have wanted out of the 2A title game.
Yes, and you know, now they see Zach is back in the game, and so now we're going to see if he's going to give the Duplin some options now on the offensive side of the ball where they ran the Wildcat the last couple of times. Now they have a quarterback back.
The more usual offensive look for East Duplin, certainly what we saw early. And, you know, gave you a weapon as he steps right behind him. This is going to be tossed to Hall instead, and he's coming across the 35. That's about all. You know, you can see the spring in the step of the Reedsville Rams. Can you not, Melvin?
I was just going to say what a difference a series made. That defense right there looked pretty good. But now, you know, now it's about who's going to finish the game, who's hungry. These last 7 minutes is going to determine our outcome depend on their output.
And just step back for a moment and think about the contrast. We may have a first-time state champion if East Duplin finishes it off, or we may have number 20 for Reidsville. This is going to go one way or the other across the next 7 minutes roughly now that we're ticking under 6:45 to play. Brown did punt the football. He did stay in defensively. Now he's back in there as the field general, and he's going to turn and give it off far side as Cade Kennedy was looking for room, but there is none. And that lift that the Reidsville offense provided visible as the Rams have them behind the sticks for third down.
Well, it started on the defense for Reidsville when they had the stop.
Yes.
So they're picking up from where they left off when they got that stop early in the quarter or late in the third quarter.
You know who was right in the middle of that again? Weiderman was right there. Tamir Johnson there, another of those senior leaders alongside the junior Weiderman. Third down, they need the 45-yard line to move the chains to the Panthers. Otherwise, they'd be giving Reidsville the football back with a chance to take the lead here with just under six to play. Fans seeing everything they could have hoped from the effort of these two teams, and a timeout is going to be called for here as they want to talk it over. While they discuss things, let's go down fieldside, check in with Rebecca once more.
Well, I asked Coach Teague, who's one of your emotional leaders on your team? And he told me senior Tamir Johnson. After tearing his ACL his sophomore season in the playoffs, he missed his junior year to recover. So when he came back this year, Tamir told me that he had a chip on his shoulder. He said, I had to prove that I was still the same player from freshman and sophomore year. I wanted to lead my team to states. After watching the game from the sidelines during his junior season, Tamir said that he sees the game differently now and soaked up a ton of knowledge and leadership skills from having to support from the sidelines. He learned to keep his head up and to cheer. Coach Teague said just having him back on the field again has been a huge inspiration and one of the best parts of this season.
You look to those senior leaders in a moment like this. Thanks so much, Rebecca. And she invoked the legendary name of Coach Jimmy Teague on more than one occasion there, talking about his perspective. He's been in so many of these battles across three decades and calling upon his defense right now to be the difference maker on third down.
Well, experience you cannot coach and you cannot teach, and hopefully he's passed some of that over.
Battle Holly's team, fittingly named, they've battled all year. Looking to go to the air here and tried to get it to Kennedy, and the flag comes in at the end of it on the coverage, which was provided by Lorenzo Mendoza. So Kennedy trying to get his hands free and make the catch here. One of the few times today we have seen East Duplin try and throw the football, and it looks like the flag at the end of this is going to be a difference maker.
Well, he was good all the way through that play, and as I said, you got to just take a little peep over your shoulder. He never looked back. He played the receiver the whole way.
Pass interference, defense, 15-yard penalty, the previous spot, first down.
Very difficult for Reidsville, Melvin. It was third and 11, and they'll walk off 15, and it means a fresh set of downs. Here's the contact and the flag coming in.
Yeah, you know, it's unfortunately that the good coverage, good technique, he just didn't turn and look over his shoulder.
So a first down at the 49-yard line when they sort it all out. What does East Duplin have up the sleeve here now that the drive continues? And you might have guessed it would be Gaby, but the ball comes out at the end. They're gonna say he's down. Coming in emphatically to indicate that the ball was down at the 39-yard line, or check that, the 41-yard line, I should say, where they're gonna actually spot this instead. So it's right at the marker. You're gonna get a look at it yourself here. Gaby rolling through, working his way to his back as the ball comes out. Always depends on which eyes you're looking at,
which
that eye, right?
Which eyes
I got a defender up here in the booth with me. I know which eyes he's looking at it through, but what toughness you see from Avery Gaby to move the chains with another Hardy's first down as we come down the stretch here. escaping the initial point of contact, but drugged down from behind by Paul Weiderman as the ball carrier Hall. How about the pursuit of Weiderman?
Oh, yeah. And, you know, they are going back to their bread and butter. And now the defense got to get another stop right here. This may be the game right here if they don't stop him here. They got to keep him out of the end zone.
Keep in mind, this is a Panthers squad built to try to roll up some yardage and eat up some clock, and they're attempting to do it at the 4.5 minute mark. Already in a mode of taking it down just about as far as they can.
Yep, it was second and eight.
Second and eight from the 39. Gaby.
That's probably the first time he's been stopped all day.
Yeah, lunges forward to around the 36. That average total, it's climbing higher in the state championship,
yeah.
Isn't it? Big time stop for Reidsville, though, and here comes a huge third down.
We're going to see if they're going to pass the ball again, or they're going to go back to the bread and butter.
A wing to the skies a moment ago, paying dividends on the interference penalty, which extended the drive in essence. Here with just under four to play. And East Duplin team having rolled up 266 yards on 53 plays in this contest. What do they have in store for number 54 and number four, Zach Brown under center there. Timeout going to be called for. East Duplin understanding the importance of this upcoming third down. You'll see what happens on the other side of the break.
Teens are under a lot of pressure, especially when it comes to underage drinking. They may not say a word, but as a parent, you can see the signs. We can help you help your teen. Go to talkitoutnc.org. Get great ideas on how to start the conversation about alcohol. So, talk to your teen about drinking. You might be surprised at their reaction.
So you want to be a head football coach. 17-14 state championship environment, the moment of dreams, but a third down coming for East Duplin and decision time of what to go with here. Went to the air, saw the drive extended on an interference penalty earlier, but Avery Gaby's been so good today, and we get quick movement, and Reidsville is loving it as this is going to back up the Panthers ahead of the third down play.
5 yard penalty. Third down.
We've seen both teams in untimely moments have some miscues. And here's another one. Third down and 10 when they sort it all out. The 31-yard line means it's going to be tough sledding for Reidsville if the conversion is made here for East Duplin. But it is third and 10. A chance for this defense to stand tall. Through the hole to the 34.
Face mask.
Boy, flags coming in all over the place. You think about if that's the way this goes, and it looks to be, Melvin, with the way those flags came in, an extension of the drive on what would have been the interference call, and this would do the exact same thing. Boy, tough, tough moments for a Reidsville defense doing everything they can to get off the field here. All three flags being picked up as we speak, and here's
personal
the verdict.
Foul, face mask, defense, first down.
A third down and 11, and you had the interference call. A third down and 10, and this grab of the face mask is going to extend the drive one more time.
Yeah.
Again, still in a position if you're Reidsville where if you hold to a field goal here, it's a one-possession football game, and you have a chance to go down and try to win it. So the difference in a field goal or a touchdown, everything for East Duplin with 3:26 to play. They have a fresh set of downs, a Hardee's first down in the Talk It Out NC red zone. Talk It Out NC, start the conversation, stop underage drinking. The Talk It Out red zone chance of the day right now for the Panthers of East Duplin. And he's taking that clock down a little further here before snapping the football. 15 when they do. And staying low and moving on through traffic is Gabe, and he's not going to be denied until he gets inside the five. First and goal.
Well, you're going to the, go to the well, and that's what they're going to do the rest of the game. They're going to ride Mr. Avers back to this state championship.
2,004 yards on the year coming in. He personally averaged 9.1 yards per carry and 133 yards per game. He's already notched up over 170 yards here in the state championship on 33 carries. What will three be able to provide beyond this? Tries to get a little closer, but has stopped it around the 3 or 4 yard line. And the clock at 2:33. With timeout being taken. Starting to get down to those tense final moments of the 2A state championship game. And take a look at Battle Holly and his staff. And then on the opposite side, you see Jimmy Teague. And you'd just like to, for a moment, be able to step inside the thought process for two of the legendary coaches and coaching families in North Carolina going head to head on this final Saturday of 2022.
And just thinking about both of those guys, they'll tell you right out the gate, it's not about them. It's about those kids that they're coaching. One of the comments that Coach Battle said, and when we asked him the other day, what's important now? And he said, these kids loving one another. That's what's important to him.
They talked about the men they will become beyond the football players that they are. And here are two guys that have given their whole lives as teachers, as educators, as coaches. Their families have given lifetimes and generations. You got a father-son combination coaching on the other side. So you think about all that and what they've provided to turn these young men into productive members of society and something the community can be proud of. Well, they're trying to give them a championship moment right here to be proud of as well, to go along with it. And here is East Duplin keeping it on the ground, stacked up at the three. And remember, play it to the end. If we learned anything on this day, right?
Wait until you
hear the whistle, and there it is. And the clock stops with 2:25 to go. Reidsville doing everything they can to hang in there in the shadow of their own goal line.
Yeah, and you know, you got third down, two more to keep them out. It's still not over.
Well, again, one more stop right here on third down. East Duplin has to make the decision about kicking the field goal. If it's six, you're going to have a couple of minutes left if you're Reidsville to try to go down and win the football game with a touchdown and an extra point. So that's how big this third down play is about to be.
It is big. And don't forget now we got a block punt, so a block field goal. So we can get that again and get 0 points out of this.
Yeah, if you weren't with us earlier, we had a blocked field goal on the East Duplin side of things that was returned for a touchdown, a play that Elam Moore never gave up on, even though the ball caromed right back into the hands of Reidsville after the blocked kick. Elam Moore snatched it away, took it the distance for one of the turning points of this contest. And, you know, you think about that, you think about the punt earlier that Zach Brown had the ball come right back to him. Ended up rushing forward for what was almost a first down. There have been some major memorable moments here, perhaps none bigger than this third down play with the state championship in many ways on the line here. What will East Duplin go with? Panthers up to the line on third and goal. Gabe, you might have expected,
they bring it
to a stop at the 5 yard line. It's going to be fourth down, but his location put it right between the hashes for the kicking game if they so choose. That's Melvin.
True. Well, that was a good call about defense. It went with a run blitz right here. Everybody got through and made the play.
Everybody being the combo of who else but Flippin, who's been one of the key wide receivers, and
Wiseman was there.
All right, 2:20 to play. It's going to be fourth down from the 5 yard line. Goal to go in a 3 point game for the 2A state championship. This is what they had in mind when they started the year. You know, you talk about going all the way back to lifting and summer ball. And, you know, you ask an interesting question, who practiced at 11 o'clock in the morning, right? Because that's what they've ended up having to do here. It's the mid-afternoon hours now, and everybody's wide awake for the balance of this one.
But, you know, we're looking at where we are in this game right now, 17-14. They make this here. we still a touchdown away. And when we got 2 minutes and 20 seconds, that's plenty enough time. We just saw a two-minute drill ran with a minute and 30 seconds and came up with points.
And remember, Reidsville did it at the end of the first half with 2 seconds on the clock. The catch was made on the final play of the half, in essence, to even the score. Then they would be trying to win the game if they could go down and get the job done this time. But East Duplin, with the offense out there, trying to win it right here. And they'll swing a pass into the end zone for the touchdown. It ends up being Cade Kennedy.
Kennedy.
Whose number they call, and on the first completed pass of the football game, East Duplin has made it a two-possession contest with 2:16 to play. Think on it now. No passes completed in the contest, and they look to the senior Cade Kennedy on a roll of the dice on fourth down. How about that call from Battle Holly and his staff to put it in the hands of their offense, and they have extended the lead to 10 with 2:16 to play.
Well, I would have never guessed that they would have gone for it on fourth down. And only their second pass of the game.
Sometimes you come and play for a state championship and hope things go well and try not to let things go the other way. Sometimes you come out with the mindset, we're going to win this championship. And you saw that from a hungry Panthers team trying to bring the first title all time home to their community against the standard in 2A in North Carolina in Reidsville.
It's against the standard, but to make that call at that point in the game, that says a lot about that coach and how he feels about his players, that they can get the job done, that he trusted that they can do it.
And it speaks to how battle-tested they've been all year. You remember those two Wallace-Rose Hill games, 28-26. Then, of course, 13-12 in the regular season against rivals. You know, they've done it in tight contests throughout. We said he's appropriately named, right, Battle Holly, because this team has been battle-tested all season long, and they earned that confidence, and they just executed the fourth down play. 2 for 3 on fourth down in this contest, but the second one, a big one. It may end up, a lot of football left here, but it may end up being the call of the state championship for what would be a first-time champion Panthers group. Here comes the return for Reidsville. Again, a lot of time left here, and how about the special teams response? Here's Neal up across the 50. He's got the speed to cut it back, and he is going to go the distance. Deontay Neal says not so fast. He gives Reidsville a lift with the return of the kick, and we're right back where we were in a one-possession game with 2 minutes to play. Wow. Nothing like high school football and nothing like these North Carolina State Championships across this weekend, right?
Well, I tell you what, that right there is a testament to that coaching staff over there not to give up until the last whistle is blown. And that's what Coach told us the other day. We're going to play till the last whistle is blown.
Deontay Neal, he caught the touchdown pass that put Reidsville on the board earlier. He had 14 of them coming in, 3 of them on the defensive side of the ball. And now he has a special teams touchdown to go along with that, and he has 16 of them on the year. And the extra point from DeYoung is good, a critical extra point because it keeps it at a field goal game. Here's one more look at the touchdown on the kickoff return.
And he just outran the coverage. That's just clearly, he outran the coverage right there. Didn't need but really one block, and that was block the kicker.
I'll tell you one more great thing about Deontay Neal, freshman.
Correct.
Going to be around for a while. We're seeing young players make tremendous, tremendous plays with all eyes on them in the state championship environment. And here's a young man again who had a couple of rushing touchdowns, 9 receiving touchdowns, a handful of defensive touchdowns, and now he has a special teams touchdown to go with it.
In the state championship game.
In the state championship game, no less, with the game on the line.
With the game on the line.
The
so we got
mark.
2 minutes left here. If this defense bow their neck and get the ball back, we might see that 20.
And DeYoung's extra point critical because it kept it where he could perhaps put his foot into it and tie things up if Reidsville can simply get the ball back. But we'll say this also. This is a Panthers team for East Duplin designed to do what they need to do right now across the next 2 minutes, Melvin.
Yes.
Getting set for the NC 529 kickoff. We may see another couple more of these NC529 kickoffs. Why not, with the way things have gone so far today? It's never too early, never too late to start saving for your child's education. Never too late to join this game. If you just found us, right place, right time. Three-point contest for the 2A title. Reidsville rolling the dice on the own sides, and they pick it up. They celebrate the onside conversion, and Reidsville, they're going to talk it over, make sure it went the distance.
I think he called it a yard too soon.
The officials are gathered up. If it holds, Reidsville would have it back. But they did blow the whole thing dead, and the conversation happening as we speak. As here is our referee to walk you through it.
On the field, the ball did not go 10 yards. Touchdown.
So the call, it did not travel the distance. And East Duplin will have the football. Still a lot of time left. You know exactly what Coach Teague is saying. Look up there at the screen, he said. They're going to show you the replay. You're seeing it right here. And boy,
oh, it's mighty close. It's closer than I saw with the naked eye.
Just on that line when it was picked up. Reidsville almost pulled it off. But again, a lot of football left here.
Still,
defense still has a chance to do
the job. Defense still has a job.
2:03 to play.
Boy,
in
that
a wild 2A title game. Everything you could have wanted out of this battle between a team looking for a first-time title in East Duplin and the Rams of Reidsville, who've done it so often, looking for number 20 here today. And the Reidsville D able to cover up the ball carrier initially. And remember, Reidsville had to use those timeouts on that prior drive down on the goal line. So, you know, it's going to be interesting to see just how much time East Duplin is able to roll off the game clock here, Melvin.
Yeah, and, you know, we're looking at it, and they're running it all the way down on the clock right now. So they won't be snapping the ball inside 5 seconds. So we're at 1:35 right now.
If Reidsville can get the football back, it's going to be with very little time remaining. And think on this, one more Hardee's first down could be a championship Hardee's first down for the Panthers right now. And a flag is down before. Before the snap, not what you want to see. A false start penalty that backs East Duplin up. That's going to make that Hardee's first down that could mean a title a little further away with 1:21 left to play. Clock in motion on the play clock side with 20 seconds to get up to the line. And Zach Brown does so. Turn, toss it to Hall. Hall is gathered up after a gain of about three. Boy, even a play that it looks like Reidsville has covered pretty well. Still a handful of yards here and there. And one more crack at it on third down and 12 to try and force that key fourth down if you're Reidsville. And the clock just dipped under 1 minute remaining. Play clock at 22. Zach Brown. Avery Gaby, who's been among the heroes today, as you look at Brown right there. Trying their best to exhaust this clock and turn it into a state championship moment. Clock at 37, play clock at 4, and there's a knee. As it'll reset with 30 seconds on that game clock, no time will be left. It'll run out on Reidsville. And they'll run near side, the Panthers of East Duplin, as they hang on for what is going to be a first state championship heading back to that community. 24-21 is going to be the final, and the pictures tell the story. 100% effort on both sides, everything left on the field in this one, and they'll watch the final ticks roll off as the East Duplin Panthers, Battle Holly and Company, are the champions of 2A.
It's their first championship.
Second trip, they made their way here just a handful of years ago. It was memorable weather. It was a tight contest decided by a couple of points that go around 16-14. This time they're on the other end of what is a 24-21 victory. Boy, you think about Duplin County, the football they play down east there, what it means to this community, and for East to now have their title, Melvin, and for Battle Holly, alongside of what the Holly name means to North Carolina and high school football in December, to have one of his own as well, making this team 2A state champions. What a memorable day in Chapel Hill.
Oh, yeah. So, you know, it's big. We talk about these small communities and how big student athletes are and sports are to these communities. And we talk about East Duplin and what Holly has done there with the tradition that Tiga has done over in Reedsville. This is what high school football is about. This is what people pour their resources into to support these student athletes. You know, this, unfortunately, somebody has to win and somebody has to lose.
Ultimate display of sportsmanship here as, again, it becomes a title in 2022 for East Duplin, and the Panthers head coach, Battle Holly, standing by with Rebecca.
Well, Coach, East Duplin is the 2A state champion. How do you define what your team just accomplished?
Unbelievable. This is what's happened the whole run of the playoffs. We won it the last minute. Guys have fought. It's just they had faith in each other. This team's God-led. We got some kids that just believe and have faith in each other. It's just great for our community. We've never won a state championship in football, and they worked really hard, and just proud of them.
You got tears in your eyes. Why is this one so emotional?
It runs deep, you know. Coach Aldridge. Coach Aldridge has built this program, and we've been here together, and it's really good and special.
What are you going to remember most? What are you going to remember most about this team and this senior class?
Our seniors, they led. We always say you're only as good as your seniors, and our seniors are pretty good.
Well, Coach, go enjoy this one.
Thank you, sir.
Guys.
Well, it ends up being old school football. He talked about hard nose, old school, what his dad passed on. For generations, that family has impacted North Carolina high school football. This community has embraced football like few communities do anywhere in the country. And it's East this time out of Duplin County. East Duplin, the Panthers, champions of 2A. We'll come back, take a look at some of the highlight moments as well as the individual performers in the 2022 championship for East.
The need for officials has never been greater. Without officials, we don't have this. Make the right call.
Become an NCHSAA official. Visit nchsaa.org for more details.
We are also pleased to honor several individuals.
Well, a hard-fought season and a hard-fighting runner in Avery Gaby. He had the first touchdown of the contest. He carried so much of the load tonight with 184 yards on 37 carries, the latest of his 100-plus yard games. And he is our player of the game, brought to you by West Shore Home, America's most admired home remodeling brand, West Shore Home. Congratulations to Avery Gaby, our player of the game. Here's the play of the game. It is a never quit reminder from Elam Moore, Melvin.
Well, you know, it's never quit, but also understanding the rules of the game.
Pays dividends for this crew. Turns into a state championship moment, as that is our West Shore Home play of the game. Rodrigo Sanchez doing the nice job to get in there, provide the block. He is going to be selected by the North Carolina High School Athletic Association as the defensive player of the game for East Duplin. It's going to be Naziah Hall who will be credited with the offensive performance of the outstanding variety. And then, of course, just like we showed you on the West Shore Home side of things, it'll be Avery Gaby, the senior running back who had 2,000 yards on the year and a near 200 yards again here tonight, who's going to be selected as the MVP. You see the Reidsville superlatives, McCain on the one side of the ball being honored, and Neal on the offensive side of the ball, that defensively, offensively. Remember, McCain had the strip of the football to earn himself defensive player honors from the High School Athletic Association. And then the offensive performer, Neal, who had the catch and so many other moments. And now the announcement's being made. It's a lifetime full of memories for these young men, Melvin.
Oh, yeah. This is what they come out in August 1st when the season starts. Set those goals for the season, and to see them to come true at this point. This is what their hard work, where their classmates are still rounding out their summer vacation. They're out there working, and this is what the payoff is right here.
Well, those two, the offensive and defensive performers of the standout variety. And you're just about to see the hardware handed to Avery Gaby, who was everything you would have expected the senior to be in this game. Remember, he had to run a good portion of the game at the quarterback position when they were without Zach Brown for a period of time. So he did just a little bit of everything today.
Well, he's the commander. His nickname is the commander, and he took charge and felt and looked very comfortable running the Wildcat with those direct snaps. And so he did more than what was asked of him.
And here is the commander. He will always be remembered as the most outstanding player of this first championship going back to the land of the Panthers as East Duplin has closed the deal, got the job done. Think on this now. They ran 63 plays to 47 for Reidsville in this game. And they accumulated 297 yards. They threw and completed just the one pass, threw a couple, completed one, but it was the touchdown pass on the fourth down roll of the dice in which Battle Holly and his staff decided, we're here to win this game and we're going to do it right now. That one completion, the difference maker as they turn it into a title.
And you know, and as I said earlier, before we came on the air, I told you that it was going to come down to the team having the ball last. East Duplin had the ball in their possession last, and they came out victorious.
When it mattered, of course, Cade Kennedy on the receiving end of that touchdown pass on fourth down when, you know, the question was, do you kick the field goal, try to go up six, trust your defense? Do you try to win it right here? They decided to win it right there. Win it they did. A first championship all-time for the Panthers of East Duplin. When you remember their season, and think about it, Wallace Rose Hill, 28-26 to get here. That was as big for this group as what happened today, you know, in many ways, because it was the second time after the 13-12 game in the regular season that they dealt that to their rivals. When you reflect upon their 2022 year, what are your takeaways, Melvin?
Well, I think Coach said it in his closing remarks is that those kids, they believed in one another. You don't win the number of games that they won close unless you trusted that guy beside you. And they trusted those guys that lined up beside one another. And when you look at their season from the second game on, and you look at the three-point win, the two-point win, you know, that's about believing that guy next to you. And that's what it's about. That's what high school football is all about, is building that camaraderie and trusting that guy that lines up beside you.
To do it in 22, to do it against the standard in the state of North Carolina like Reidsville, what a moment for East Duplin. They go 15-1. They reel off 14 consecutive after that early loss that you talked about in order to turn it into – a state championship moment. Well, we say thanks to you, all of you who made these broadcasts possible. Thanks to everybody working hard for you in the truck, on the field, on this cool December Saturday. A little more holly in December in North Carolina. Why not? The latest of the championships and the latest of the big moments for that family and for this crew. We also say thank you to our sponsors. We would like to take a moment to thank West Shore Home, North Carolina Department of Health and Human Services, College Foundation of North Carolina, Hardee's, Talk It Out NC, NC529, and Ingalls Markets. Without their support, without their partnership, these championship contests would not be available to you. But we appreciate your support of high school football, of the North Carolina High School Athletic Association, and of Sinclair Broadcasting. It has been our joy to bring these championship moments to you. Congratulations to all the champions who will emerge this weekend, and in this case, congratulations to first-time champions East Duplin. The Panthers win it in 2022 over the Standard Reidsville, a moment they'll never forget. We leave you with the sights and sounds from Chapel Hill. Enjoy the holidays. Merry Christmas. Hope it all goes well as it did for East Duplin here in this one for everybody out there in TV land.